everyone. Welcome back to the Hive. This is going to be the, I'm your voice, Sexy Shay, for the Widow. I have lovely Ms. Nada. And then, of course, we have our guest star. You all know him, Tarian Rain. I hope I said your name correctly.
You said it right.
Okay, good. So, welcome to the spoiler review section of Wonder Woman 1984. Mm-hmm. I, unfortunately, was not able to make it to the spoiler-free one due to family, but I'm here now to the, I would say, the
you know, Christmas.
You hear in the part where it counts.
It matters.
Yes, I exactly. All right. So the panel wants me to go first, give my initial thoughts and whatnot. So you ask and you shall receive. So I say, like I said, my Twitter post that I left the theater seeing Wonder Woman 1984 with a slew of emotions. My initial reactions is that if you're looking to my comparison to this in the first one, I feel as though I personally can't, only because I feel like this is like another chapter in Diana's life, where the first one is like her beginning, and during a time of world of war, so it's a different field of setting. Versus this one is just where she's like, you know, 67 years later, where she's in tune with her powers. Like, she's like OP in this film. And not just her, but also the Lasso of Truth. Like, god dang, I didn't realize you can do so much stuff with that lasso. But again, it's magic, so makes sense for me. And you know, I would say Maxwell Lord, he did an awesome job. He's very compelling. His motivations was there. One of the scenes that I'm sure we'll talk about when we get into the full details of the spoiler review is that made me very teary-eyed. And honestly, I don't know why, but it really affected me. Hit the heartstrings a little much right there in that point, in that one part of the film. And you know, Cheetah, I was thoroughly pleased with Minerva's. I would say I wanted just a little bit more, but I am satisfied with what was given. I felt as though they left it open for a character to return at any point given in time. And as far as Diana, like I said, it's another chapter of her life, and you know, she's in tune, she's more confident in her abilities, and you know, we see her journey throughout the film that, you know, she's just kind of been saving the world here and there, but not really getting intimately involved with people, because we all know she would not age, she won't grow old, so unfortunately, but people, human beings will, so that kind of like, it's kind of like a, in her turn, and when it comes to her, it's like a deal breaker, because she'll keep living, and you're like, oh, well, you know, it's heartbreaking, so... one of my favorite moments we'll also talk about is also seeing the Golden Eagle armor. I love seeing that for the first time over on the big screen, especially with the theme music that came with it. Yes, and the music, oh my god, Hans Zimmer did his thing in this film. I love it. Mm-hmm. I left the theater hopeful, you know, not depressed, and you know, contemplating my life and choices and everything. Jeez. you know. And as far as like the MacGuffin of the film and how C. Trevor is back, it makes sense. Mm-hmm. Right? It makes sense. It was actually very crucial to the story. And also one thing we'll also get we'll touch base on in the solo review is that one of my theories that I spoke with Nada about was correct.
100% correct.
Involving the MacGuffin.
I wonder if we had the same theory.
I thought of you the whole time. I was like, you know what?
That's right. I was like, yes, I knew it. See? O'Shea Dahmer's here. All right, but let me
see. I feel like you had some inside information, because you were spot on with that. You were spot on with it. I was like, he knows something. Mm-hmm. Share with me.
Listen, the only thing on how I knew about that, like I told you, I before the film, all the crazy stuff, they had released a novel that had information about the first.
You did talk about that.
So I read some of that, and the MacGuffin was in that. I was like, oh, okay. Shut up.
Spoilers.
Yeah. Yeah, that novel was would have been spoilers. So that's probably why I didn't really recommend no one to actually get that. Yeah. Otherwise, you'll just be spoiling yourself.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Oh, as far as compared to the first one, like I said, if I have to do it, just for the sake of it doing it. Okay, so the first one's here. So I said, they're pretty much tied to me. But both films, it's a different feeling for me personally.
Mm-hmm.
From the first film and then this one. This one definitely has, I would say, had a lot more of a compelling story, in my opinion. And
emotions. This whole movie was emotional.
Mm-hmm. Very emotional, and it hits you in the heartstrings very heavily. Like, and I'm not one to just tear up like this at all in theaters ever. So I applaud Patty and them for actually making me actually cry. Like, ooh, I was holding them back so much. But that's just me, though.
I was a mess during this movie. I'm gonna go ahead and say it. As I told y'all, you know, before, I was emotional, like going into it, just, you know, so happy that the day had finally come. You know, I feel like it's been pushed back, and then with everything that's been going on with COVID with everything that's been going on around. And like the movie just keeps getting bounced around. Is it gonna come out? And I personally feel like this was the perfect time for it to get released. Like, I'm not gonna say it was meant to be this way, but it was on time. We needed a film like this to come out at this point in time to give us hope. One thing I will say from Wonder Woman, the first Wonder Woman and this one, is that they always made me feel hopeful when I walk out the theater. I'm always emotional. And I'm always hopeful. And if I may go ahead and like just give you some of my opinions on it, Kristen Wiig was amazing. Pedro Pascal was amazing. He actually made me feel for Maxwell Lord, which I wouldn't think I would feel for a villain. But like I end up leaving this scene where, you know, I can see where he would do something like that, you know, which is crazy. Obviously, Gal Gadot does her thing and Chris Pine. Like, Gal put it all on the table. Her emotional range in this film was amazing to me. I do want to say I am not a professional movie critic, so if you want me to tear this movie down, I'm not going to do that. I enjoy good films. I will admit when I see questionable things in films, but I also think that a lot of people forget that it's a comic book movie. You have to suspend reality to a certain degree in comic book films. Yes, we wanted to look good, we wanted to look pretty, and it did. It obviously delivered on the whole thing, but some things that happen, you gotta be like, well, it's a comic book. So, like, am I really looking for them to really go into depth and explain all of this in this film? But having said all that, I thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm going to watch it repeatedly, probably right after we get finished with this stream. Wow. I'm gonna go watch it again. Because I can, you know, that's the beauty of having it in the theater and now HBO Max at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
So those are my initial thoughts on it. Taurean, take it away.
Yeah. So, I just really enjoyed this movie. Like y'all said, it was a mixed bag of emotions. Like you had moments when you were shocked. You had moments when you laughed. You had moments where you damn near cried or completely let out the ugly cry. Like you're just going to hold back. Like this, then that's what a movie is supposed to do. It's not supposed to be just a one note type of movie because that's boring. It's supposed to be like a roller coaster ride. And that's exactly what this movie was. It had its ups, it had its downs, it had its in-betweens, and it had its earth shattering moments. Like shoot, like when you think about earth shattering, like when you think about the stuff that happened in this movie, you're surprised that the Earth is still in orbit because a lot of stuff happened in this movie. And it's crazy because it's like it all became connected in the end. Mm-hmm. And it's crazy from one minor event exploded into chaos. And what's scary about it is that could, if you think about it, in a way, if you take some elements out, could almost happen in real life. And I think that's the scary part about it, because like I was telling Nada earlier, I had to take my family to go see it. And my mother was saying how that's scary that something like that could actually happen, like in real life. Like you could just be like minding your business one day and all of a sudden something just gets shot up into the air. Yep. The thing is, we don't have a Wonder Woman in real life to stop it. No. We don't have a comic book superhero that will prevent it from happening. If something goes off, it's going off, and wherever it lands, it will land.
Yeah, and we got to pick up the pieces.
Exactly. Or shoot, in some cases, you might end up being in pieces.
This is true. Right. This is true. Well, I will say I do like the way, if we're going to get into just a little bit of the story, how she was introduced in the beginning of the film. It was like just brief flashes of her. Mm-hmm. And that's how she kept her anonymity throughout, you know, these years. And it would make you believe that's why Batman didn't know who she was, hadn't heard of her before, you know, he encountered her or whatever. But, you know, like the opening scene with the Firebird, I think it was a Firebird that was racing down the street and it was about to hit the lady. And then you see her kick this car and it spins out. And then you see the flash of red and blue and gold. And then she's doing like little heroic things, which O'Shea was talking about, I think, just last night, right?
Yeah.
We just talked about last night. He said, you know, I want to see her doing little things, building up to the big stuff. Like that she's around, but she's not really well known. Because when they were talking about her at the mall scene, you know, after the whole mall thing went down, which I'm gonna go ahead and say, that was very, it was very campy, right? The whole mall thing. You got the bumbling burglar, or not even burglars, but the guys who, the would-be robbers for the jewelry store.
Yeah.
And you got the one who's just like an idiot who couldn't get it right, you know, drops his gun in plain view of everybody, throws down the bag of the valuables that they stole, and like picks up a kid and dangles her over
the balcony. Yep.
So he does all that. He's like going to the extreme. He's like, is that really necessary? But I also think that it was nice to me, because if you look at how the film transitions from beginning to end, it starts out like really high up, kind of campy, happy-go-lucky. It's the 80s. Everything's good. Da, da, da. So, of course, you come in and everything is exaggerated, right? So that kind of fit for me for it to be like campy like that. And Diana dealing with the little girl, sliding her into the teddy bear, which was really cute. And, you know, telling her to be quiet and all this kind of stuff. So the campiness worked for me. When I first saw it, I was like, what? But then I had to remember, like, this is a comic book movie. You know, this is how they're going to start it off. It gets more serious as the film goes on. So I appreciated having that moment of campiness in the beginning by the time I got to, like, the second act of the film.
Yeah.
So what do y'all think about that particular, the beginning of the film?
Well, look, because it was shot in the DMV area, I was going to support it regardless.
They can do no wrong for you.
And I know exactly where that mall is. And it killed me when people were reacting to the first trailer and said, is that the mall from Stranger Things? I wanted to go into the comment section like, no, that's not the mall from Stranger Things. It looks like it, but it's not. Because back in the 80s, all those malls had that same aesthetic look. Like they all, like nowadays, most malls, they have their own look. But back then, they all looked the same. But when I saw that, and the thing is, the name of the mall is called Landmark Mall. There was nothing there in that mall. That mall was completely abandoned, and they opened it up just to shoot that scene right there. And I remember when they were doing production down there, they had all the cameras and the cranes and all types of stuff right there. I can imagine how chaotic it was to shoot that scene where they had to run and scramble all over the place. Because someone, you know, was asking me, they said, are those real people? Are those background? I said, no, those are background actors. And the minute that they yell action, they just say, we want y'all to just start yelling and screaming and acting crazy and running all over the place. Don't try to bump into anybody, but, you know, find a spot we want you to, like, run to and everything, but make it look natural. But that just shows you right there how realistic it looked. You know, if someone sees a gun and, you know, you have one person yelling, it's like herd immunity. Everybody else is going to freak out at the same time and whatnot. So, seeing that, I have to agree with you when you say now that was a real campy type of scene. It was like a very like you know, it was like the opening to a show or something like that. And you know,
the Superman movies, when I watched it, it put me in the mind of Superman would do campy stuff in his films. So when I saw it, I was like, oh, okay, I can get with it. You know, I think Patty's taking us back to the old school way of doing superhero films. Because yeah. she's bringing back, it's a superhero film based off a comic book character. So there's going to be an element of campiness that is just going to be there. You yeah. know, they can all be like super serious all the time.
Exactly.
That's what most these people want, which is why prior to this review and watching the film, I read or watched some of the reviewers who had a chance to see it, especially the ones overseas. And, you know, most of them were literally expecting just serious in everything in their aspect of the film. And
it's a movie, though. Like, unless it's a unless it's a biopic or something.
But you're using that, but also, and like physics. Explaining everything, I'm just like,
it's a comic book movie. You have to suspend like some form of reality. You have to suspend and say, it's a comic book movie.
Yeah.
That's why we watch it. When we watch cartoons, when we read comics, and they do things that seem impossible, you know what I'm saying? That's why we're like, that's amazing. So now why are we acting surprised when we see it in live action? You know what I mean? Like, that's my whole thing. The whole point of a movie.
You know why? I'll tell you why.
Do tell. We weren't going to talk about it right now.
All
right,
but listen. When his film came out, every film that's not looking like his, it's...
We just got three thumbs down because you're saying Snyder.
You know what? Like, I told people, listen, you can come up here and talk to my face, okay? Look, I ain't scared. Show up then. Pull up then.
I think people forget that a movie, like Tarian, you know, said it earlier, you go in and you take a break from reality, right?
Mm-hmm.
You want to see something that you don't normally see every day,
right?
To differentiate from the everyday mundane stuff that you deal with. So when you get it, you know, now if it's too far gone, obviously then it kind of pulls you out of the film. But I feel like this was just enough. It was just a little teaser showing a little sense of humor with things. So I really appreciate that as an opening, kept it really light. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, we went into, I think what was it? We met Barbara. We see her running. We see the character of Barbara. She is, very interesting to say the least. So I'm talking too much, so I'll let y'all go on about Barbara.
Yeah, when it comes to that character, like I was telling you earlier, I'm glad that they allow Kristen Wiig to keep some of her comedic element to her going into the character. She's a very awkward, shy, open person. You know, she tries to see the good in everybody, even though a lot of people don't see her or see the good in her. Like, for instance, the person who hired her, she didn't even know who she was. She said, what's your name again? She said, my name is Barbara. You hired me like a week ago. She was like, oh, okay, whatever.
All right, that's right. Okay.
You know, she reminded, it made me think of, y'all seen Office Space? Have you seen the film Office Space?
Mm-hmm.
And I can't, what's the guy's name? Norm? What is his name? The one that's down in the basement. They keep moving his desk. She reminded me of his character because she's like, oh, it's no big deal. And then she kind of says something under her breath like, but you interviewed me like three times. So like, you should know who I am. Things like that. Her character had me smiling from the second I saw her. Even her just doing that awkward speed walk.
And couldn't walk in the heels.
Struggling in them heels like, oh Jesus Lord, no. You set them off.
But let's say she had an evolution. And
yeah, she definitely had one of the best character transformations I've seen on screen, mm-hmm. especially for a comic book movie that I've seen in quite some time. And they did it very organically. Mm-hmm. It wasn't rushed. Like yeah. you literally saw her evolve mm-hmm. all the way to Cheetah. You literally saw her go from Barbara, shy Barbara, then saw her go into I'm getting a little bit more confident Barbara, then you saw her into more sassy Barbara, then you saw her to more threatening Barbara, to then Cheetah. Then now at that point, she's so far gone. At that point, there's no turning back. Yeah. So I'm glad that they didn't rush her transformation. Like, we got to see her, like, levels of evolution, literally, with her character going forward. But we're going to get to that part. We got a while before we get there, but we're going to get to that
part. I'm trying to walk us through it, but I don't want to crawl through it. So so we get the introduction of Barbara. Barbara meets Diana, who is, let me just tell you, Gal Gadot was stunning in this film.
Yeah.
I mean, like, scene to scene, until like later on in the film when she started, you know, things started to happen. But every time you saw her, she looked like, I mean, I know she's a model, but she looked like a walking model. Just Yeah. Everything that you saw here from the beginning.
Right.
Immaculately dressed. I mean, come on. Can we talk about the fashions? Can we talk about
I think they really captured the 80s with the clothes that they decided to go with. Like, it really made you feel like you was in that time period, especially if you weren't from that time period. You got to look at what it was like if you were from that time period. It took you back to that time, because the people who I was, the people who I was with my parents, because I had took them to go see it, they actually came to this area to start working in 1984 and, you know, in DC. So when I was asking them, I said, that's how they look back then. That's how they dressed. That's what they wore. That's what they drove you. Like, yeah, that's how they look back then. So, you know, if you get the authenticity right, it pulls you in. And like I was saying, this film was very bright. And that's what the 80s was. It was very bright colors, very loud colors, as they used to call it. But opposed to the first film, which was during wartime, which was very dark and depressing. You don't bring that to this. It wouldn't look right. So I'm glad that they got the color scheme right. They made her suit more bright. They made they lightened her suit up a lot.
It was so good, especially in the clouds.
Hold on, we're getting ahead of ourselves.
I'm so excited. Okay.
Slow down. Yeah, the clothes and the hair. And being an 80s baby myself, not to date myself too far, but I grew up in the 80s, and it was like nostalgia for me to go back and see, like, some of the stuff I saw those people wearing, I had that same stuff. Or I saw my parents wearing the same stuff. So I was sitting there just like, this is amazing. They're just on point. You know, costume and set design was amazing. I'm going to sound like a fangirl. I'm not a fangirl. I just appreciate it. Because I appreciate the way that movies make me feel. I don't get caught up in the technical aspect of films. I look at how they make me feel from beginning to end. And this movie made me feel amazing. I went in with a smile on my face, and it just got bigger until I couldn't hardly take it by the end of the movie. And then, you know, the tears flowed in between. I'm going to go ahead and tell you that right now. Everything just made me emotional when I watched this movie. Seeing Diana, because we get introduced to Diana kind of through Minerva, the other way around. And she's the only person who even pays attention to Barbara when she first comes around. When she's this mad scientist, well, not even mad scientist, but just this bumbling scientist they bring in as a gemologist. Even though she has like every degree in the book, it sounds like. Right.
Yeah,
basically. She's a cryptozoology, gemology, archaeology, just all the ologies, she's got them. So she's incredibly bright, but totally awkward. But you see Diana kind of extend, you know, the hand of friendship to her. And I think Diana sees something in Barbara that she likes, like that she wants to be. Because she said Barbara's like free, and Diana doesn't feel free because, like O'Shea said earlier, Diana doesn't form relationships with people because she's going to outlive them all. Right, so she's free to like be herself and really create these friendships and bonds with people. And you start to see how lonely she really is. And that was the first one I kind of got like a little emotional. I didn't full on cry, but it was a little tingle. When you see like Diana's really alone.
Was it the scene when she was sitting down at the table getting ready to eat, and the waiter came over and asked her, is anyone joining you? She was like, no. And he just started picking up the silverware and the menu, and he walked off. And everything like that.
Table. Did you see her face? Like, if she watched him clear the table, she was like, it was just the saddest thing. Like, as he picked up more stuff, she got sadder and sadder.
Yeah, because, you know, she was looking at the people, like the couples have relationships, and she, you know, she sees that and she dwells on what her and Steve once had. And it's crazy because that's the first time she's ever loved a man. Because all she knew was the Amazons, you know, living around a world full of women. So she's never felt that intimacy with another man before. So Steve was like her first in every aspect. So, you know, they always say you never forget your first. And that was that. And you got to imagine that lingers with her every single day through decades. And she hangs on to that. And whenever she sees people who are happy in relationships, she, you know, you can see the expression on her face every single time. And it's of sadness. And then for her to look up in the sky and always see a plane fly by, and that's the last thing she remembers of Steve before it exploded. So, yeah, I can see what, you know, right there, why that would be an emotional point, because it's like the world is passing her by, but she's going along with the world, but, you know, she's kind of stuck at the same time. While everyone else is still moving on and growing older and moving on, you know, doing things, she's growing, she's moving forward, but she's not, it's some things that she cannot do that she wants to do, but she knows that she can't.
She's not moving forward emotionally.
Exactly. But
what I will say, and that's what happens when you have a organic growth within the stream, you get things out of order. Because I totally forgot to start with the opening of Themyscira. Like, that's where we started.
Gorgeous, that opening scene of that film.
I don't know how we got there.
It's crazy because when they showed the opening scene, like when they were doing the premiere, I said, I know this isn't the whole scene because they only showing so much. Right. And that was a very interesting scene right there. And you know, when she, you know, when she looked back and she fell off the horse when she was winning, and then she decided, you know what, I'm going to take the shortcut and cheat. And I knew she wasn't going to win because she didn't even hit her target. Yep. And then, you know, when she came back and she got, and right when she thought she was going to make it and she got snatched up, she's like, nah, she's like, I'm not going to let you win because you cheated. Right. And she felt dearly, she felt in her heart that even though she knows she cheated, that she still should have won. And that was like the beginning of her growth process right there. And that was the overall theme of the movie, was truth. Like, she was always saying that you have to be a truthful person. Like, you're not going to get anywhere based on lies.
And, you know, so, on that, you know, that's where some people actually in their reviews post it as actual, as a critique, because they actually did not understand what was the point of the opening scene.
She literally, it was a whole exposition.
They literally missed that whole point, what Taryn just said. So it's like, I'm like, okay. And, you know, and to be honest, truth, yes. I thought, in my opinion, it was also truth, but also greed. Especially when it comes to a certain scene with Master Lord and people all over the world. I'm like, yeah.
The thing, you know, Antiope served as a, she was doing all this exposition about doing the right thing. It's not worth anything if there's no honor in it. There has to be truth. If there's truth, then there's nothing. I also took from that, you know, the whole reason that she ended up falling behind is because she kept looking back. Yep. So I think there's also like a theme there about moving forward and not looking back. Mm-hmm. Like, not getting caught up in looking back and being distracted from the future, which I think is what she was doing emotionally with Steve. She couldn't let go of what she had with him in the past, so she couldn't really move forward. She could never really get as far as she might be able to because she can never let go of what happened in the past. So that's what I gathered from the whole opening credit scene. I mean, the truth thing too, but with her riding the horse, because the whole thing, she kept looking back, kept looking back.
Oh, Nada, you just gave me a full circle moment with that statement you just made, but I don't want to say it right now because we haven't gotten to that part, but I hope that I remember. Yeah, I might have to write that one down. Yeah,
write it down.
I got to write that one down because when we get to it.
That's what we do is what we do.
Everything comes full circle.
Yeah, because what you just said, and the thing, I wonder if y'all going to pick up on it too, but I don't want to say it just yet because we haven't gotten that far yet into the review.
All
right, Lord, but yeah, seeing Themyscira again was amazing, as always. Like when I first saw it, like it started with her running, and then the music was building, and then you see like these Amazon games. You know what I mean? Like you see this competition going on. You see how big and colorful and bright and majestic that it is. And I feel like it, first of all, I'm always glad to see Baby Diana. I'm always gonna call her Baby Diana until she
loves Baby Diana. Mm-hmm.
I love Baby Diana. We see her running. You see how beautiful it is. And she's just coming up. And it's like you see the world through her eyes. Everything is so big. Right. And then to see like the stunt work for those Amazon games was amazing. The camera work and the stunt work was like amazing for me.
And and this is why, if I had to get, you know, technical, the fact that Patty Lee brought old school filming to this film, that using a lot of practical effects with minimal CGI, using actual people.
Because
she said when Amazon was like running on those pillars, she said those are real people doing those stunts. So you know, I really appreciate her bringing back some nostalgia in filmmaking that's not necessarily used a lot in films nowadays.
Exactly.
So, Ryan, anything you want to say about the opening scene, since we're kind of jumping around a little bit?
Yeah, like that opening scene was just, you know, phenomenal. And that was another emotional point. Not so much emotional for me, but more so, you know, at the end, because she really felt that she should have, she deserved to win that. And you can tell by the look on her, face. It was one of disappointment, anger. Like, you could tell she probably wanted to flip her lid because she wasn't able to do it. But we also got something else out of that scene, too. We got a first glimpse of the Golden Eagle armor.
Ah, we did.
We saw it as a statue. Mm-hmm. And we saw it as a statue. And I'm going to leave it at that because I don't want to go too far into that until we get to the story behind that.
Okay, let's move on. So we've hit the opening, probably halfway through the first act right now.
Yeah.
Maxwell Lord comes on the scene. He's suave. He's a shiesty salesman.
He's a finesser. Yeah, for sure.
Woo's finesse Barbara.
He does finesse Barbara. Oshay, why don't you go ahead and fill us in on that?
Yeah, good man. Maxwell Lord, there's a little change to who the character is from what people know of him in the comics. But for the story's sake, it makes sense. So he's this basically big TV ad guy that's like it's on all the screens. They're like, life is good, but it can't be better. The whole speech about this all throughout the film. And, you know, so when we see him, you know, being introduced, we're thinking, okay, trying to suave, sell your typical sales guy trying to woo you, finesse you out of your money or whatever. Of course, and of course, he had to pick the person of all people, Barbara, shy, nervous, you know, Barbara. And next thing you know, she's like, head over heels for the man already, biggest fan already. And even though secretly he's already becoming a mastermind,
he's plotting
already. Said, whom? I'll use you
to get the stone.
Stone, of course, yes, the MacGuffin is a stone, which also ties to one of my theories that I was correct on.
And we already gave you credit for that. Like, let's
Of course. But, you know, but since we're spoilers here, you know, like I said, so the MacGuffin, it was a stone that ties to the Greek gods. Yes, they are mentioned, specifically to the Greek god of lies. I don't remember the name. I know Diana probably said the name. I just didn't hear
it. She didn't say the name, but his name is Dolos. That's the Greek god of lies and mischief. I don't know if she ever even, she says one of the old gods, but I assume that she meant Greek.
You can tell she was shook by this because usually she's not too scared of anything, but every time she talked about it, she had this very frantic look on her face, like she could have ran for the hills. Right. You can tell that what it was. And then when you get later on in the story a little bit, when they start explaining how many times that stone had to travel from place to place throughout history, and what it did after it was, you know, completely used up. I wouldn't want, and I said, listen, I don't even want to come across a stone in real life that looks like that. I'm like, keep that thing over there. I don't want no parts.
No. But yeah, it belonged to the Greek god of lies, and you know, how she would explain it to see Trevor. Kind of jumping in just a little bit, a little backstory about, and she said basically, you know, that, you know, there were gods that weren't really good,
and had different purposes and
like that. And God of Lies, he imbued the power into this stone that he made, this crazy stone, of course. And it is a monkey's paw. Mm-hmm. You get something, but it takes something
away
from you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that the Dream Stone, I think, is what they were referring to it as. Actually, is from the comic. It's from the pre-crisis time and with DC. The story's a little bit different. We're not gonna get into that whole thing because it's kind of like we're not gonna talk about it. Anyway, the story's a little bit different. But like you said, this is a monkey's paw, and it lies. Like, it goes into, it gets your, whatever your wildest dream is or whatever you wish, it gives it to you, but then there's a downside to it. Barbara wishes to be more like Diana. Diana secretly wishes to have Steve back, which is how he ends up coming back in the film. But he comes back in the body of another person. So his spirit comes back.
Yeah.
But I know some people had issues where they were like, why, if you can bring him back, just bring the whole person back. But I think his body was destroyed, so I don't know how they would physically bring it back. Because I think the stone still uses things that are physically around to make stuff happen.
Yeah.
So that's why I think his spirit came back instead of like his corporeal body. You know what I mean?
Still uses magic in a sense because it's Greek, the gods, yeah. Right, and they use magic in their powers. But mm-hmm. I think it has to be something physically. And unfortunately, C blew up.
And one thing I've said about this stone is that everybody had a consequence that they had to deal with after wishing on it. Like even, and I like the fact that even Diana had a consequence, because I probably would have been off if they didn't give her a consequence, even though she's the hero. Mm-hmm. I'm glad that she had to face or deal with some kind of adversity for her decision of wanting to bring Steve back. Barbara had to face a consequence for wanting to be like Diana. Mm-hmm. Maxwell Lord had to face a consequence when he decided to make himself the whole damn stone.
Right. The
MacGuffin. I didn't even see that coming. Honestly, when he said that, I was like, "Whoa!" I was like, "I was shocked," because I didn't know what he was. At first, I thought he was going to ask for all the money in the world or something like that. That's what I thought he was. I didn't know he was going to actually make or manifest the powers of the stone into himself.
And then look what happened to him, though.
He went stir crazy.
he started to deteriorate. And what Tyrion is referring to is, so with the stone, it traveled around the world in different significant eras in time. And every time the stone left a place, that civilization failed. Exactly. Or just like, was completely wiped away. So Diana was like, that's what's going to happen here in this situation. Like, all this is going to be wiped off because of this stone. This is the power that the stone has. And you see Maxwell deteriorate. The more that he uses the stone, he has to use it. Mm-hmm. It's crazy how that works, because his body's falling apart. He's like, I'm going to take this from you to give you that.
And one thing also, too, to go back a little bit, what I thought was interesting is when he was done trying to finesse, or after he finessed Barbara and went back to his office, the lobby and the everything looked nice, but when he got up to the office, it was nobody there. He had no workers. It was barren.
Yeah, big old pretty building. And once you get inside, it's just empty, which is kind of like Max, because, you know, that's the thing where you see that he's not who he pretended to be, and that he was actually just like, he was struggling. He had some issues, which were revealed later on in the film, but mainly he wanted to look good in his son's eyes, which I think is kind of what motivated him to do all this shady stuff. Yeah. So when you look at his motivations, is he really a bad guy because he was motivated to look good in the eyes of his child? No. Is he a bad guy? Is he a true bad guy?
No. In some aspects, no, but the way he went about it, of course.
Oh, he went full villain.
It got the best of him. Like, he couldn't stop. Like one thing wasn't enough. And the thing is, he could have been stopped. He could have stopped, but he got addicted. He grew a lust for greed. Like, mm-hmm. this man literally committed all seven deadly sins in this movie. Oh, yeah. and if there's some more out there, he probably committed those too.
Mm-hmm. Ares hated humankind in the first Wonder Woman. I think this in my mind, and it may be reaching, but he despised Zeus's creation of mankind. And he was like, they're filthy, they don't deserve it, they don't care about each other, they do all this stuff. And I think having Maxwell be the epitome of greed and lust.
It goes back to what Ares said.
He said, like, our human nature by its very nature and design is the lowest base level. Like, we're going to do something to, it's self-satisfaction. It's all motivated by self-satisfaction.
Exactly. And, you know, and I'm glad you mentioned that. You know, the first one's about proving if Ares was right or wrong. Of course, he was right. Mm-hmm. And then this one, it basically expounds on that in the sense of humanity's greed and mm-hmm. lust for more and just more. And just, of course, it's just done through an object created by one of the Greek gods. Mm-hmm. But I'm glad that they still kept it consistent, that the, as far as, you know, like, to making it, I guess, in an instance for the story, believable, that you have with Diana, she's tied to the Greek gods, so something that mm-hmm. has to happen is mystic-based, basically, something with the gods. And this one has to be one of the objects. Because at first, I was literally thinking Hephaestus, but then I was like, oh, okay. So I just didn't know that some of the gods could actually create certain objects or something mm-hmm. for people to use and obviously abuse.
Well, I think that if I want to segue, if I may, since we're already on this topic, into the topic of direction with Patty and how Steve was introduced.
Yeah.
I thought it was, in my, you know, I could figure it out as I watched it. I know some people struggle with trying to figure out how is Steve here but not here? How is he in somebody else's body? How is Diana not seeing this other person? But like when Diana walks into, she's trying to find Maxwell and she ends up walking by this guy and he says, like, Diana, I've been looking for you, whatever. You see that he's a stranger to her. And then he pursues her and she's like, why are you talking to me? And he says, like, I wish we had more time, which gets her attention. And then she's like, what? And she's starting to figure it out. He puts the watch in her hand and he repeats that whole, I can save today, you can save the world. Like that. And so then you see the camera work as she's talking to him, spinning around. And it's like spinning around. Every time it goes around, she's like, what? And she's looking deeper, trying to see who it is. And by the time it pans around for the last time, we see that it's Steve. So in my mind, I said, oh, this is Diana kind of figuring it out. And we're seeing her visually figure it out and see that this is Steve's spirit in this man's body. And that was another talking point that some people had issues with, but it made sense to me the way that it was done. I don't know if you could do it any differently without it being like super campy, like smoke and mirrors and all that kind of stuff. And they'd be like, it's me, but I'm inside this other body. Right. And they even, you know, referenced it later on when he was at the guy's apartment and he looked in the mirror and he saw
basically explained like, oh yeah, I'm not really here physically. I'm literally occupying someone's body, which
he said something similar to that again.
Right, that part. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Which ties in something that happens later. I was like, wow, like everything literally comes full circle in this film. That's why I love it so much. That's what I like about it so much. But you know, okay, so Max Allure is just to Barbara Minerva. Of course, he's after the stone. And then also, I love how Diana's also using her experience of knowing so many languages. She gets easy reading that. And Barbara,
she's like, right. She just looked at it one time and just already knew what it was saying.
Right. Well, she's like struggling. Like, what's it say? And she's like, oh, it says it's like, really? Oh.
She's like, oh, it's just a hobby of mine. I thought it was funny when she was like, when she met Maxwell and he's doing his whole, life is good, but it could be better. She's like, I don't know what this is. And she's like,
I don't even own a TV.
I was like, really? You don't have a TV?
And he's like, I can hook you up with a guy. You know, we'll get you a nice 19. And she's like, I'm good without a TV. I'm good. I don't need it. A little comedy, you know, a little light sprinkle comedy in there.
I think the people in my theater, they probably laughed at that. But I think somebody kind of took it left field when he said 19 inches. I'm just like, why you laugh? What the fuck? I'm like, girl, this lady was crazy. But anyway, not to get distracted. But yeah, so from there, does it, if I remember correctly, was this, Diana and Barbara have early dinner, early dinner. And he just kind of had like a little character building moment for both of them trying to, you know, see each other's point of view on life and how they were, and that how Barbara sees Diana as like this perfect individual. She has everything, you know, she's beautiful.
But she's not happy.
Exactly, but she's not happy yet. Mm-hmm. Barbara, she's very happy, but to some degree, but awkward, and no one notices her, you know, because she doesn't look like Diana. Mm-hmm. And of course, being in the 80s, I'm sure that was like a highlight. You know, if you look good, all the men, you get all the eyes, everybody looking, checking you out.
But that was such an 80s trope thing, because like every 80s movie has the nerdy girl that goes to hot girl. You know what I mean? When you look back at those films, like, I don't know, Sweet 16, 16 Candles, whatever it is, like you see the girl who's socially awkward and kind of a wallflower, and all she does is like take her glasses off, shakes her hair down. And then boom, right. Like, hey, so like, what's up with that? I mean, I think that was a very 80s thing to kind of do as well. But like I said, Kristen Wiig really showed us like Barbara's evolution. And it was nice to see like little pieces of it as the film went on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think her, and you know, what happened to it with Barbara, I think it's kind of sad really, you know, because all she wanted was just to be noticed. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, but I feel as though when it started to became, she's turned to more of a darker turn. I think I personally believe that that's just years of buildup.
Being neglected.
So when she has this power and opportunity, it's just like, it's understandable why she wouldn't want to give it up.
It's totally based off this whole film touched on aspects of human nature, right? We all want to be accepted. We all have the, I don't say tendency, but greed is a real thing. And everyone can fall victim to greed and lust and all that kind of stuff. Like Barbara, you know, Diana, Barbara imagines Diana's having this perfect life. Diana's like, it's not as good as you think it is. You know, I have things that I wish I could do that I can't do, and I see that you do them. Diana saves Barbara from being attacked by a drunk guy in the park, which I thought was a really cool scene because I really thought like she wasn't going to swoop in. I don't know why, but I felt like something bad was going to happen to Barbara and that was going to make her jaded. I thought that's how we were going to get her to transition from being this like meek wallflower to being Cheetah. So I was like, well, this is about to happen. So I was a little sad, but then I was glad to see Diana swoop in and save her. And it was kind of funny because she was brushing off. She's like, oh, self-defense is really easy. I'll teach you. Don't worry about it. Meanwhile, the guy's like on the other side of the park, busted up.
And did you see Barbara's face? She's like, sure.
So she's putting, she's like, something's going on here. So she's like, Diana's even more amazing than I thought she was. But then a callback to it, once Barbara started to change and evolve, that same guy approached her at a later time. But now she about that life because she's got a little power, got a little speed. And she got a little attitude behind
And her. I didn't even, and you know what, the trailers didn't do her justice. I did not realize she was moving that fast. Like when she was running.
Oh, yeah.
Because I didn't realize that she was moving that fast when she was running.
And that's not even winded. Like even when they showed her, she was talking to people as she was running. She was like, what's up? Nah, I'm busy. No, thank you. And then when she, like I said, when she encountered that guy again, she gave in to her baser nature because that guy had attacked her before. And I think that anybody who had been in that situation, when you have, when the tide is turned and the tables are turned and you have opportunity to straighten some things out, like I did not feel, I didn't feel like she did anything wrong when she beat the hell out of that guy.
And I thought that was interesting that they played the music that they played when she was attacking him was also very interesting for that scene, because it's like she, whenever they played music around her, it was always some kind of happy-go-lucky type of music. But when they played that music, it got dark. So it showed that. And then it even showed when she, when the homeless guy said, Barbara, what are you doing? She said, mind your business, and ran off. I'm like, wow.
She was
real cold. She just kind of, she gave him a stank look and said, mind your business, and continued to run down the block.
Early in the film, we learned that she would feed this guy.
You was just giving her a free meal.
She had a new attitude. You know what I'm saying? It was a new Barbara. I'm just saying, you know, you get caught up in the, it's like when people get fame, they get caught up in it, and it starts to change the way they act and, you know, do normal things. So I, you know, what I appreciate about it, just like with Maxwell, his was a little advanced though. Like his went really fast.
Yeah.
Like him going from like being shysty, greedy, insecure to being like a madman. That it happened, but I guess, you know, when you got magic involved, it happens very quickly. With Barbara doing her whole Cheetah transformation thing, you just saw like personality change.
People think that Barbara wasn't given enough to do. That she was just added in the film.
Now, I don't know what more she could have done. There was a lot that was going on in the film. Like, I think they spent a lot of time on Maxwell and his stuff. Mm-hmm. I feel like maybe a little too much time was spent on him because the movie is about Diana, but I guess you got to build the villain up to give him agency, to give him a reason for what he's doing. So then when the time comes for the big conflict, the final battle, you can be like, okay, now it's paid off. So that is one of my minor critiques, that he might have got a little more time than he should have.
One thing I thought was funny was when after the day after Diana and Steve, you know, encounter each other again, and they wake up together in bed and Steve is there eating a Pop-Tart. I said, and he said, these are so good and they only give you two. Like, why did he only give you two? I said, I feel the same way. Why did they only give you two?
But he also said he ate like three boxes of them, right? Did he say he ate like three of these or something like that?
Yeah. I said that can translate over to real life because a lot of people can crush up like three boxes of Pop-Tarts in a day.
You probably could, yeah.
And I thought, you know, also, you know, them showing, you know, him changing out the clothes to see what he would wear to go out and, you know, explore and everything, you know, everything like that. And I thought what was funny, because this film was shot in my area, when they showed that train station scene, when they went down there, I said, wait a minute. I know exactly where that train station is. I pass that train station every time I have to go to work. And when I saw that light flashing for the green line, I said, that's Branch Avenue. I know exactly where they were standing at. I've stood on that platform in that exact spot. So I know exactly where that is. So I feel like this film has a connection to me because of where it was shot at. Yeah. So that's why I always mention the DMV when it comes to this movie.
Can we talk about, because you've now brought me to that point that's set me up for the alley-oop, parallels, right? Parallels mm-hmm. with this film and the first Wonder Woman. So there's a role reversal, right? Diana was a fish out of water in the first one, and this one, Steve's a fish out of water. They even parallel that down to the wardrobe scene. Yeah. You saw Diana in the first one going through the wardrobes, and then we see Steve doing the same thing. Diana's trying to explain how things work to him. This is art. This is whatever. So I just thought that was really cool. Even to the train station moment.
Yeah, when he had to get on the escalator. And the thing is, when that escalator part came up, I already knew what his reaction was going to be. He said, so these stairs right here, they move by themselves. Yeah. So he's like, okay, he stepped on it, he kind of got scared. And then when he was liking, he started walking up the steps as it was going down. I said, I knew that was going to happen, because in almost every movie where they involve an escalator of some kind and people are experiencing that for the first time, they are so fascinated by it that they start playing on it like little kids. Because, you know, kids would do something like that.
It's funny you say that, because you could see in his face, it was like childlike amazement.
Yeah.
At how things have, he said, this is an amazing time. Things are just so amazing. And, you know, 80s was peak America. It was like peak everything. So, you know, his mind was blown, and rightfully so. He was thing like high definition to go from World War I 1917 drab wartime to this world of abundant color. Yeah. And they traveled the world. They went, you know, they were tracking when Diana figured out what was going on, she had to track down Maxwell. Mm-hmm. Ended up going to Cairo. I think Maxwell is going in more pursuit of power, greed. Mm-hmm. He's granting all these, he's getting people to, the way it works is because he's the stone. He has to make them make a wish. Mm-hmm. And the way that he goes about it, because he's a businessman, it makes sense. Let me hold your hand. Let me shake your hand. Let me get you. Don't you wish that this would happen? And the people just fall right in line and be like, yeah, I wish that happened. Yeah, sure. And boom. Whatever.
Exactly.
So, you know, he's over there. We see what's happening. Like, you see the decline and what's happening in society start with Cairo. And then you see on the news that back in the States, because of that, What do we call it? It's not snow. It's kind of like snowball effect, but y'all were talking about it before, like how one little thing
monkey's paw part,
but like how it still has the pebble in the pond effect, how it ripples all the way out and affects everything. So they're in Cairo dealing with what Maxwell has going on over there, but because of the wishes he's granted, it's also starting to affect what's going on in the United States. Right. So then you see that the whole world is starting to, you know, coming to this conflict. And Diana, at this point, if we didn't talk about it, but Cheetah wished to have Diana's powers. Diana wished to have Steve back. And her trade-off was that she would lose something that was valuable to her, which was her power.
Powers, yep.
And the way that they, like, kind of showed that, like, I didn't pick up on it initially. And
I did.
That was okay.
I did in the trailer. When she was able to jump through her gauntlets, and when she caught the lasso and held on to it and swung her, that's how I said, wait a minute, she has to have gotten weaker, because there's no way that this person can beat magic like that so flawlessly. So I picked up on that early on.
Well, let's O'Shea credit, because O'Shea called that about.
Me and Nolly were doing like a segment of The Hive, and we had watched the main trailer from DC Fandom again. Mm-hmm. And then I saw that too, the scene where you point out, Tarian, that I was like, wait, she just did the barrier. Ain't no way, anyone who gets in contact with it always gets blown back. but that thing looked really weak and like it faded away.
Yeah, it was small because usually that thing is so powerful that it could like literally like it's almost like a sonic wave. Like it should have knocked everybody back.
Everybody, even the whole White House could have possibly been destroyed if she did that.
Yeah.
So I was like, something going on, and which is why I devised a way. I told Nada maybe somehow based on the MacGuffin, the film, that Cheetah is actually is cycling away Wonder Woman's power.
He called it spot on. He said Wonder Woman's getting weaker, Cheetah's getting stronger. And I was like, No, Shay, that's not it. Something else is going on.
But before we even really go right into that, let's talk about how now, thanks to this film, the Invisible Jet is no longer a running joke. They handled that one perfectly. Oh, I said, finally, this now that's the Invisible Jet right there. That is it. It
makes although out of place, that's where I got emotional. When that happened, I was sitting and I was like, they really did it. They brought the Invisible Jet in the movie. And it worked. Worked. Like you see that first of all, it was cute. She was like, I'm gonna see, I did this one time. Let me see if I can do it again. When she said she lost the coffee cup.
Yeah.
She made it invisible. And well, I was
and
like
and it makes sense. And why it makes it because like, I think people really forget from the first time that we found out she's the daughter of Zeus. Zeus also created the island of Themyscira and shielded them with his magic. So
and she naturally
she's the daughter, offspring.
And I thought that was interesting too because I was wondering how they were going to do it. I'm like, is this some kind of technology that she has to put a code in to make it invisible? But then when she used her magic to do it, I said that's perfect. But I like how they did it, and I don't know if y'all was really paying attention to it, but I saw how like when they were flying in the sky, and if you looked out the window, you could see the wing, like you could see the outer like the lining of the wing, but it was invisible. But you could clearly see the lining of it. And I like that scene of them flying through the fireworks and everything. That's good cinematography right there. Mm-hmm. And then flying above the clouds, and you can see the lights below the clouds. Like, that's perfect. And I like in that conversation right there, Steve is hinting that Diana could fly. Like, he's like dropping subtle hints. He's like, you know, there's a possibility that you could do this too.
God. I was like, Patty, are you going to give us everything in this world? He said
it's easy. He was like, it's easy. Just, you know, become one with the wind. Do this. You know, it's easy like flying. And I was like, this is beautiful. The cinematography, the silhouette that you saw when it was flying through.
Yeah.
I mean, it was amazing. Like, you could definitely see what was going on with it. And like I said, everything that was around, flying through the fireworks, flying over the clouds, like, everything. It was...
That was in it, and it made sense as to why, because she's the daughter of Zeus. She can also use the magic that's like her father to shield things from somebody, so basically turning invisible, which is how the mascara is invisible to everyone else.
But now, you know, let's talk about you know, when they are in Cairo in that road scene. That was so smooth how they did that when they were driving along and they driving past and she said, that's Maxwell Lord. She said, here, I'll give you this money right now for your car. And he gets in the car. I'm like, how is he going to get back? He's stranded in the desert on the side of the road.
Money, and that's it.
And then they start driving and everything like that. And all of a sudden she puts her costume on, she opens up that door and just starts galloping out of there like it was nothing.
That part, it was so funny to me, just because she was like, I got it. And we still don't know how she changes. I said, I don't know how she does it, but she like had the headband, she's like,
and that's why I said, well, maybe since Patty's such, she loves Donald Superman, maybe because, you know, in that old film, this is an old one, when he would jump out the window, and he'd see the civilian club, but it was just kind of fade away and he's already in his I think that's kind of like a nod back to that, how she was just automatically like in her armor and he's like, oh, you just had the armor.
I like how they gave, how they allowed even Diana to have her own little puns in the movie, because I felt like they didn't give her enough of that in the first one, but they did with this one, because after she got out of the car and started to push that tank across the road the way that she did, like it was like it was nothing. She hopped on that other car, pulled off that steering wheel and said, at least your brakes still work. And then all of a sudden the thing turned off the road.
That was, I was rolling. Like, I, that whole scene, that, that whole scene, first of all, looked beautiful when she did it. But at this point, you know, keeping up with the story, she's starting to lose some of her powers, you know.
And she started to struggle, especially when she had to tip over that one thing.
She was struggling to push the truck off her. And I said, when I saw that, it reminded me of doing a leg press. Like, if you do a leg press, that's exactly what it looked like to me. And, like, she was struggling to push, like she was struggling to push that truck back. And Steve had to come in and put a wedge in between to prevent her from getting crushed. You can tell she was getting weak, too, because when she got shot, you know, that's the first time we saw her draw blood. So that was a sign right there. She was getting weaker. And also, too, when she used her lasso and she couldn't hold on, she slipped off when she was carrying the kids.
Yes. And she knew something was wrong. You could see in her face, she was like, what's going on? And she could feel herself getting weaker. She still tucks and rolls and like protects the children. But she's like, I'm gonna have to take this on because this tank is barreling down on her. And she knows she's weaker. At this point, she's about to sacrifice herself for those children.
Right. Yeah.
And also, but also the very first time I saw her strength dwindling away is when she tried to break off a lock on the gate.
And she was like, that should have been an easy yank for you.
And that's when we first noticed
when she was starting to get weak. It was like that part right there. I said, oh, I know what's happening. She's weakening, like her powers are getting like very weak.
But and then, so Steve noticed it too, right? Because Steve brought it to her attention, and she's like, they know the whole monkey's paw premise behind the stone and all this kind of stuff. He's telling her, you know what you got to do. And it was touching to me, once again, another emotional moment when they were, I think they were in Diana's apartment. I can't remember. He was like, you've got to let me go. And she says, I haven't asked for Diana's apartment. She says, I love what I do. She said, I do this because I love it. I'm not complaining. Mm-hmm. She's saying, I never asked for anything after all this time. The one thing that I want, you tell me that I can't get. The one thing that I asked for, she's like, I ain't giving it up. And I told her the thing. It's all about human nature. The one thing that you desire, and when you are doing all good, and you are doing all this for everybody that's being selfless, but just a moment, she wanted to be selfish. Superman, too, when he wanted to be a regular human being, and he started to lose his power. Same thing, parallels.
And it's amazing because you would think one thing I liked about this movie is that even though she's a very powerful being, she's pretty much God level, she has vulnerabilities like every other human being.
Oh yeah.
And like, you know, her, like it shows that she's no different on that level than anybody else. Like she has her ways that every other human being is not to the extent like every other human being, because I think she can control it to some point. But I think that sometimes when it comes to Steve, her emotions get the best of her. And you got to think, like I said, this is a person that she lost in a tragic way that she's always thought about for like every day of her life going forward. And now that she finally has this man back in her life, she doesn't want to let that go to the point where she will sacrifice herself to be with him. And even he knows that's a risk that he's not going to allow her to take. And that's one thing, one dynamic that I like about their relationship. Is that she doesn't want to let go, but he wants her to let her go, wants her to let him go for the betterment of society.
Right.
So I think that's very interesting. And that's something that you rarely ever see in films. Usually it's a swap. Like with as far as the genders go, it's usually a swap. It's the other way around. But in this one, they do it so organically and it's so believable. Right. And it's actually leading into that full circle moment that I had to write down.
Before we get there, let me just say how this and also in Wonder Woman 1 and in Wonder Woman 84, speaking with Steve being like the more mature one emotionally.
Yeah.
Diana is still naive, right? Steve is the first man, her first love, and she hasn't been able to let him. He was the first. Her first everything, right? And then she lost him tragically. She never moved past that point. Steve had lived life long enough to know there's going to be other fish in the sea. You know, you're going to love somebody else again. You're going to do all this kind of stuff. You still see, even though she's a more seasoned hero, Diana's still naive. Like, she still says, I want this. Like, when she was saying that, it took me back, and this might be your full circle moment, but it took me back to when she was a little girl, she was crying when she didn't win the competition. She's like, but I want this.
Yeah.
And somebody's like, this isn't the right way.
And it also goes back too, because it's not just so much of her losing Steve, it's how she lost him. Mm-hmm. He died in a plane explosion. It's not like he died of natural causes or of old age, and she could probably let him go like that. She lost him at a point where he just entered her life on an intimate level.
Yeah.
So it's like he was in her life in multiple phases for even a short period of time. But when it got intimate, it became something else. She allowed herself to be or give herself to him, and she's never done that. So that was a whole nother aspect for her. And you got to think, she went through life not giving herself to any other man. And I'm sure she has had offers. You know, I'm sure she's had offers. We saw it in the movie. Yeah. So she just could not bring herself to give herself to any other man like she did Steve. That's why, like when you said she became selfish, even though he knew what she was doing was wrong and it wasn't right, because he knows that. You know, she has a lot of work to do. He knows that she's going to be around damn near forever until she, you know, just goes away. And he's like, that's not a risk I'm willing to take. He, at that moment, was thinking about everybody else.
Oh, right. Exactly.
You know, I'm going to give you my full circle moment right there. We can go back. So, you know how we were saying how, now I got to try to remember it. When you saying about how she is like selfish and everything like that, and how she had to face all these consequences and everything. The part after, and we can go back to it, after the White House scene and he's carrying her. Uh-huh. That part right there is what got me, because that was the most emotional acting I think I've ever seen Gal do in this role. Like, she was crying. Like, she was like, Steve, I don't want to. She's like, I can't let you. He's like, listen. He's like, you have to let me go, because you have, like, this one was more emotional than the end of the first one when he got in that plane and took off, because she actually was leaving him this time again. And it's like his body is like, he's still there, but he's not there. And she was like, look, I gotta let you go. And the part that really got me was when she was crying as she was walking away and was saying, I renounce my wish. I renounce my wish. And she, and as soon as she said that, that speed picked up and she was booking.
Her body healed.
Her body got healed, and then she launched herself up. That was the scene I was waiting for ever since I saw it in the trailer. And one reason why is because I know exactly, that's on a place called Patriots Plaza. That's right there in front of the Capitol by the FBI and all of, you know, FBI building and all of that. And somebody, when they were filming that movie, somebody was recording from a building of the scene of her running down that street. She was hooked to wires. That was not CGI. She was hooked to wires, and it was pulling, they were pulling her at a very fast pace. So it made it look like she was running really, really fast. But that scene right there, when she was crying and running away saying, I renounce my wish. I renounce my wish. And then she launched herself up with the lasso. And that's when she really, really was ready to go in. Because at that point, she's fully back. She's gotten all her strength back. And she's ready to now really, really fight. You know, because and you can tell that was hard for her to do, because she didn't want to do it. But she knew she had to do it, because I'm going to be honest. Barbara was giving her that work in that White House. Giving her that work.
Right. It was like, okay, Diana, I think it's time for you to kind of, you're going to let him go now. Because
Barbara gave her a three-piece and one of them dry-ass biscuits from Popeye's, and Diana was not ready. She was ready.
Exactly.
Before I go, because I'm just thinking about it, Taran, is making me get emotional, because I remember how I was feeling when
just like I said, you know, the White House scene, it was, to be honest, I feel like that's where the intensity, the emotional meets was start to happen, you know, even after Steve, you know, had to say goodbye again. But also the fact that, you know, when Steve said that, you know, well, you know, I'm already gone. So, you know, and that, you know, I think that part really got some people as well. It's like, yeah, technically you are. And, you know, and the fact that when she was walking away, he also said, wherever you are, Diana, I will always still love you. And it's, and you know, that part was so touching. And, you know, and the fact that she was crying, walking away, because she knows she has to do a duty. She has to save the world, because the world is at the point it's going to chaos. Maxo Lord has gone into overdrive to 1,000. He literally just got the president himself to make a wish. Nuclear missiles.
He got the president.
Oh my God.
And when he was looking at over at the plans, when he was like, what is this? And the satellites and how he was able to touch, because he said he wanted to touch. He said, now I'm able to touch everybody now. Mm-hmm. And I like how they did, and I like how they did that and how they made it seem like that was such a new thing at that time. Satellite was a brand new concept at that time. And I like how he delivered those lines as if he was so surprised to see that now we can reach the masses on a global scale. And how he, listen, Pedro Pascal was so maniacal in that role. He delivered every line that he did. That part, that was the part right there when his nose started to bleed. Remember his nose started bleeding and he had those blue veins and he was turning pale and everything like that. He had the bloodshot eyes and everything like that. Like, you know, that was crazy. I thought it was also funny too when Steve had caught up to him and handcuffed him to him.
Before Cheetah was like, nah.
Yeah, she was like, nah. When they were walking towards him and she had kicked him back and everything like that, she was like, I need him. And it was in that scene where it goes back to when I said how fast she is. When she was running, I said that she had the agility of a cheetah, because, you know, the cheetah is like the fastest animal on the planet. They run like 70 miles an hour. She was like, she was, when she was running and swinging on the pillars and everything
on the bullets.
I said
more stuff than Diana. Well, Diana wasn't, I guess maybe a little bit, but she seemed more agile with Diana's powers than Diana had was with her own powers.
Yeah.
I saw that. I was like, oh, okay, for sure.
But speaking of how Cheetah wrecked Diana, like, we have never seen Wonder Woman beaten down. Like, as bad as she was.
And I'm glad that they did that with her, because, like I said, Cheetah is like her main adversary, and they always had run-ins with each other, so it made sense that she was the one to give her her first official beatdown. And I think that was like the, I think, because I'm gonna be honest, I'm glad that
everybody was expecting it, to be honest. Everybody was hoping that Diana would get her shit wrecked.
I mean, we did. She caught that lasso and swung her twice. Because in the trailer, she swung her one side and then swung her through the pillow on the other side. And was like, it was nothing. And then when they about to take off in the chopper, all of a sudden, she leaped.
I said, she's gonna get on there, and all of a sudden she was just on the. She was like, "You got room."
And she leaped so hard that the wind behind her blew her head the other way. That's how fast she leaped into that chopper.
So, like, you see Diana get wrecked, right? And you've never seen her in such a state of disarray. Like, always goes to how she looks for me, right? Because even when she's fighting, she looks good. It's like boom, boom, boom. But she had a beat down. The hair was everywhere. She's all cut up. She's bleeding. Steve got to help her up. Then the Taurean's full circle moment where he walks her down the street and they have to say goodbye. And you really see some acting from Gal Gadot with this one.
With that one scene right there. That's why I said that's like some of the most emotional acting I've ever seen her do. And I'm glad that she was able to convey it, because, you know, she's always been seen as a very strong character that doesn't really give emotions. But in this movie, she had no choice, because she was becoming weak. So she had no other choice but to emote those emotions. Even that scene after she gets wrecked by Cheetah and she's laying there and she's breathing hard, out of breath. Like, she's a person that rarely ever see her sweat, but now you see her bruised and bleeding and out of breath. Like, at that point, she knew what it felt like to be immortal. She was no longer immortal. She felt like amortal. Exactly. That's why when she bled the first time, she was shocked.
Yeah.
She was shocked because she never drew blood before.
Can we go back? Can we just zip back for just a second? First of all, my girl was damn bad. She was bad. She looked bad. She got beat. She was bad. Yes. Anyway, so back to Cairo with the tank scene, when she got shot and she was under the tank and then wheel went out and she had to make a decision. And when she like kicked her feet up and flipped the whole damn tank. Oh, yeah. Do y'all remember that scene when she was, when she, like, I don't know, she slid on like a lid or a door, like it was on a skateboard, and she went under there. That thing to me was like, it stuck out of me. I was like, this is some badass stuff. And even on my standard screen, because, you know, they moved it got moved from the big theater to the standard screen. On my standard screen, it still looked amazing. I just want to say that now we can move back forward to what's going on in DC, because her letting go of Steve and getting her powers back, she took off. Like, she jetted out of here. And
we wanted to know for the longest, what did she attach herself to? What did she lasso onto? It was a building. No, it was a building first. And then she lassoed onto the plane.
And then what happened?
Exactly. She remembered what Steve said. So,
she started to fly. She was floating. Then she started to fly.
I cried again at that scene.
The clouds, her armor, hair, everything. It looks so majestic, beautiful. I'm like, watch it. Now that in that scene, I wanted to low-key cry, but tears wasn't coming yet.
I did. I cried. I mean,
I cry of disappointment, of anger, of frustration, of WB. I was like, where is the goddamn Superman film? Look how often this shit could be. Ever could be in tears watching Superman look this damn good, like Diana, saving the day, bright, beautiful day, costume popping, everything, being the character that he is and everything. Because it'll be serious in tone, but not who the character is. I'm just like, yes, Patty.
There was more parallels there with how Superman was learning to fly as well, just a little bit, because she was trying out some of the same stuff. But I thought it was
I think, you know, they fly differently in the sense, you know, I think Superman flies because he manipulates gravity, and she uses her magic.
And I thought
he flies on the winds, and then.
And I thought what was dope is that. She initially, and I am, and my theory was right too, because I told Jody about this when he did a reaction to the DC fandom trailer, when she was using her lasso in the air and it was like pulling her forward. I said that looks like it looks like she's propelling it, and I was right, because she was doing that. When she was propelling it forward. But what I liked is that how they transitioned from her using the lasso as a crutch to her putting it away and then just flying.
Like baby, like training wheels on a bicycle.
Like training wheels on a bicycle. And then when she got into her groove of flying, she was flying on her back. She was doing flips and rolls and tumbles and tucks. Like she just she couldn't stop.
Meanwhile, the world is in chaos below her, and she's like, "Let me just get myself together. Y'all work out till I get there."
Right. And once all that's going on, one of the most epic scenes that we saw in every single trailer, her swinging on the lightning. I couldn't wait to see that scene of her swinging on that lightning. I said, now that is very comic bookish right there.
Even just seeing her flying, because O'Shea talked about this a couple months ago, and we saw it when she was gliding through the clouds. We didn't know if she was flying or not. It was so beautiful. Like, just a beautiful blue sky, the clouds, her the juxtaposition of her bright suit against the backdrop of the sky. Like I said, she's flying on her back. She's getting familiar with it. She's trying to learn how it works, because the first time she tried to take steps, and then she started going down, and she caught, I think that's what she lassoed the plane. Get a little more elevation going, and she's learning. We're watching her learn how to fly. And, you know, in the middle of all this other stuff, it was kind of funny to me that she took that time. I guess she had to figure out how to fly so she could go back and help people. But I was like, the world is still devolving into chaos.
Right, girl, what you doing?
Like, you have that moment. And, what are we doing?
Exactly. And then the moment of truth happened, the big reveal. She goes back to her apartment and she takes the covering off. And the next time we see her, flying in on that Golden Eagle armor. Let's
talk about that theme song with her entrance of that comic.
Wait, before we get there, can we talk about the backstory?
Oh, the backstory. Right, you're right. The backstory on that, you know, basically saying it belonged to one of the most strongest Amazons, and they basically used her to get the other Amazons to safety and use her as, you know, as a sacrifice, and basically how all the warriors was trying to get to her, but it was so hard to penetrate. Like, they was going, it looked like 300, and they were struggling until she decided to succumb to it and let them kill her. Otherwise, they would have still been beating on her armor.
We assume that she let them kill her because the armor was made from all the other armor on the island.
Melted together to form.
Yeah, when they lived among man, and they were
because we for the longest we always wanted to know how did that armor get there, because we know she can't go back to Themyscira she left. So how did it get there? But it says she found it, like it was on Earth, and she found it and she had brought it back.
What she was looking for, Asteria, who was Amazon. But she found the armor.
Oh, she found the armor. It's then found her.
Yeah.
Which is strange. Like, where do you find it, though? Like, where do you put that armor where nobody else is going to get it? And how did Diana... You know, I had a couple questions about that. But, you know, I suspend belief. She found it because she was supposed to find it. Let me tell you. When I saw Asteria, because they showed the scene of her with the armor on, so you don't see her full face, but you see her eyes, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, in my mind, I said...
That can't be what's the name, is it?
I said that's gonna be Linda Carter. Like, I thought that was gonna be her in that moment with the armor. They're gonna show that she was an Amazon years ago. Mm-hmm. I got really hyped, but then it like went so quickly. But you saw how she was like fighting. It was just like 300, like all these Spartans with red robes on, they're banging on it. And she's giving the other Amazons the opportunity to get away. Mm-hmm. She sacrifices herself. Diana finds the armor because we had assumed and speculated she would go back to Themyscira.
But I was like, it's no way, because they said that she couldn't go back after she had left.
Right. And I think also, I think her mom would have unfortunately has to uphold the rules and laws of Themyscira that you can never set foot on the island again.
But so that means that she stole, never mind. She found it.
Right.
She found it.
Like, we thought she was dead. No, she's been living like Diana across the centuries and decades. Mm-hmm. Bro just retired in a sense.
Mm-hmm. And did y'all pick up how when she came in with the Golden Eagle armor and how they started to fire at her as she was coming in, it kind of reminded me of Captain Marvel in Endgame when she came in and they were firing at her as she was breaking through the clouds?
No, it didn't remind me of that at all.
I just had to throw that out there. I knew how you was going to receive it. I mean, I just had to throw that out there.
I just don't remember the film that well, so it doesn't remind me of that.
Okay.
I will say
we will scratch that from the record.
Okay. Yeah. The way she flew in, took my breath away. Like, she was like, "Let's go." I'm sorry.
I like how she did her little superhero pose when she froze and the wings expanded.
That's the theme music. I can't get over how epic he wrote that theme music, the opera, the orchestral, the theme of her when she paused for a second.
Mm-hmm.
When I was like, oh,
like an angel.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you, the soundtrack of everything made those moments that much bigger, Mm. When she came in and like when the fight was on with her and Cheetah, like that music was pumping and it was
And you know, it's so crazy, like it's like we knew it was about to happen. And I like how they even led into, you know, with Barbara now making her final transformation when she was on the plane with Maxwell Lord, and she said she wanted to be an apex predator. Mm-hmm. And then we already knew what was about to come. It was just a matter of time. And then when he had looked over at her and she started to walk away and she was moving kind of funny, I was like, I know what's about to happen. And then all of a sudden, Diana looks up and you see her standing right there. I like how they made her look, because people were saying, I hope she don't look like cats. That's what you were saying. I hope they don't look like cats. She did not look like any of that. She looked exactly how she should look, especially for a first transformation, because Cheetah has had different looks. Yep. Over the years, I think one of the most popular looks she's ever had was her wearing the pearls, having the dark brown hair and the green eyes. That's the look that people really know her for being. But I can, you know, work with this one right here, because when they even did the close-ups of her, it looked like Kirsten Wiig's face. Like, it didn't look too CG. Yep. But right. the minute that she saw her and we saw her and looked up at her and she uttered that line, Barbara, what did you do? And she leaped off and started moving and everything and bouncing off. I said, that is Cheetah right there. And even the sound effects that they were making, like of her scratching at the armor, was on point.
Can we go to that point? Because what was the point of the armor at this point? If Cheetah, first of all, this is the strongest armor that they had. But I guess, you know, during time when Spartan was alive, strength wasn't the same. I guess because she ripped this thing apart. She ripped those wings like it was nothing.
But you also got to think too. Cheetah was birthed through magic. She was birthed through magic, and that stone is very ancient. So that's not just a regular cheetah strength that she has. That's cheetah strength plus some magic. So that's why she was able to tear that thing apart.
When she was
ripping that stuff apart like that, I said, Diana, just clip them wings and just go toe to toe with her. And when she threw them wings off, she was like, okay, now she said, now I'm ready. Because, you know, these wings was holding me back.
You know, she had that. Everything she did was like defensive, right?
Yeah.
She never struck her. She was just like, let me put these wings up. Let me get you back.
Yeah, like when she closed them up and then she decided to push her off of her and then pulled and pushed the wings, and that's when she was ready to go. She pulled that lasso out, and I like how even though they were in a very small space, they utilized their environment a lot, like swinging on the electrical lines, bouncing off the walls, the running on the wall. But I'd like, and I don't know if y'all picked this up, but when she runs on the wall and grabs Cheetah by the back of her neck, and she does that flip, doesn't that look like a breakdance move?
Yeah.
It looked like a breakdance move. Like, that was one of the first things that I noticed when I saw that trailer.
And psych.
And I like also too how they made Cheetah be acrobatic. Like, she was hanging by her legs.
Oh yeah.
Like while grappling her and everything, showing that she had leg strength.
She was that fight in the air.
Oh yeah.
Oh my and god. What y'all think about the fight? What do y'all think about the fight?
I wish the fight was longer. That was my only thing. I wish that the fight was longer, but I liked it for what they did.
Right. Like it left me satisfied. But like I said, I could use just a little extra 5-10 minutes. That's it.
They said this is a little taste. If we come back for a third one, we'll make the fight a little bit longer.
Right, exactly. Which is why I feel like I low-key feel like they left that her character open, which is why they didn't kill her.
Yes.
Yeah. Which I'm glad they didn't, because I'm like, she's a main villain. Like, she needs to come back. Like, don't kill her off after we just got introduced to her.
Yeah. Also, Tarion. I think. Or also, Tarion. Now, maybe the next time if she comes. When she comes back, maybe they'll actually use the Cheetah Goddess.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because I think that's what keeps her in the form permanently.
Yeah.
So okay, we'll get to that in the end though, because we're gonna speculate about Because I'm about to go down the road with you, but I'm not gonna do that. So in the fight, I would just say I was thoroughly impressed. I could have taken about another 10 minutes. Like, and this, give me 10 minutes to fight. Give me 15 minutes to fight. Let me see what you're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that Diana basically fought her one-handed for most of it, and she was holding on to the last one, she's like, get off, fighting her with one hand and like a foot kicking her off, but then Cheetah's coming back, and you see them spinning around. And then you see Cheetah using a power line to swing around on.
Yeah, like, keep back up her,
But the power line didn't affect her, and then we see her in the water.
Yeah.
And Diana's like, you need to renounce this. I'm gonna give you one more chance. Say, I don't want to do this no more. And Cheetah's like, nah, so did me. And so she then holds on the water and she gets
away. She was like, okay, bet. And just held her under the water and just like,
I'm sorry.
I was just saying to myself, I hope she didn't drown her. And then when she pulled her out of the water, she was still breathing. I was like, oh, I'm glad she's still alive, but she did enough to subdue her.
Not only was she still breathing, but she was still like coherent. She was like, oh, I'm just a little bruised up. Like, this woman just got like a million volts.
But like I said, it's through magic. Like, she's not, so that won't affect her.
Right, it's through magic. It's just fine. So she has more durability, like Diana, to take some voltage here and there. You know, I guess but I do see some people, you know, that do that criticism that you would have now about the how she grabbed the cable as she used to clean back up.
She's swinging on it like it's a vine. And then all of a sudden, she used a subduer.
And I like the fact that they didn't have cheetah constantly on all fours because she mm-hmm. did not always walk on all fours. She walked erect like a human being. And I like how they had, because I kind of would have been thrown off if the first time we see her, she's walking on all fours. I'm glad she was walking standing up on two legs.
Yeah.
And she just kind of looked down at her and I said, this is it right here. This is it. This is the part right here that actually made me lean forward in my seat when I was watching the movie, that part right there, because I think that's a scene that a lot of people was waiting to see, like that fight right there.
Here we go. Cheetah live action.
And it was good. I thoroughly enjoyed the fight. The CGI.
And then on top of
that whole thing, but it looked good to me.
And then on top of that, this is the first time I think we've seen in a superhero movie in a long time where you've had a female superhero go against a female villain. Mm-hmm. Usually you'll have a male superhero going against a female villain or vice versa. But it's the first time you've seen two women go at it like that.
And it's not right. And it's not over the top. It's not SJW. It's like it's standard superhero villain. That's what it is. And I love it. And also to your point now that yes, like because Patty Jenkins said at CCXP that with Cheetah, they combine practical with some CGI. Mm-hmm. But she also did say that it was pretty hard doing that.
I mean, there was some little things, but it wasn't anything that took me out of it.
I like the detail of it. I like that when they did the close-up scenes of her, you could see the fur on her body look like actual fur. Even when she pulled her out of the water, she looked like a wet cat, like you know how a cat would look when they getting out of water. So I thought that was dope as well.
Speaking of water, can we just take a moment to pause and just reflect on how beautiful Diana looked with the suit on, with her wet hair, and she was like,
like, God dang, you look good in everything.
But now they said that she never wore the tiara when she had the gold eagle armor. She's like, I don't need it. Like, you can
I think that would be just been a little.
And weird. I have to give kudos to Gal because whenever she did an interview talking about when they was ever talking about the Golden Eagle armor, she always said how uncomfortable it was. She said that was so uncomfortable to move in. She said she would often complain to Patty about it, and Patty would kind of dismiss it in a comedic way, having to wear that because it was hard for her to move. It kind of reminded me of Christian Bale when he did The Dark Knight and how he said it was uncomfortable for him to move and maneuver in the bat suit like that. So I have to commend her for, wearing that because that armor that she wore, it was actually made out of some solid material. Like it wasn't something that was plastic that they made look shiny, for film effect. Like they actually made it out of like some metal. So I can imagine it weighed, I can imagine it probably has some weight to it. And I can imagine it was hard for her to maneuver. And especially she said the hardest part was wearing that headpiece. She was I can't wait to take that headpiece off.
She's like, oh, thank God. All right, let's go.
But it looked so good though. Like when she had the full thing on, it was just that moment, like in the clouds when she paused for dramatic effect.
They said those wings actually could expand. Like that wasn't film effect or CG. Like those wings actually could expand out like that.
And
like,
you see how they, it reminded me.
Detail.
It reminded me of Angel from X-Men. How he would use his wings when she brought them in, how they kind of curled in on themselves a little bit.
I like that. Shouts to Patty and the detail, and also of course the homage to Alex Ross. Golden Eagle armor.
It looked so good on film. Like it was.
It did. So now I guess we can talk about that scene with her finally going in the building and finally facing off against Maxwell Lord.
At this point, I think Maxwell Lord has like the full power of like the God of Lies. Cause like
he does.
When Guy couldn't touch him, was like, no, I'm getting all the wishes. I'm getting
She can't even get the lasso to him. And that wind, I'm like, what kind of wind machine were they using? Cause she was sliding back.
Oh my God.
She couldn't grab on to nothing. She's like, let me lasso this camera out the way. He was like still saying, wish granted.
Nah, I'm still getting all the power. Thank you though.
How I really think that O'Shea said he probably stepped into, he was really feeling all the full power that God, because that's the only thing that could hold her back. Like get through anything. If there was a wind strong enough to hold her, it had to be a God. Given God.
And you can tell, how else you could tell he was at full power? Because his son was watching the TV And his son was saying, I wish I had my daddy back. He said it multiple times. And even through then, he couldn't break through that. It was no way. And I said to myself, I said, the only person that can save him is his son. That's the only person that can bring him back to reality. But how will they be able to do it if she can't even get her lasso to touch him? Like, it was like it was not going through. And then all of a sudden, this is the beauty of it. All she had to do was just sit down and talk to him in a calm tone and distract him. And then in a subtle way, wrap the lasso around his leg. And we didn't even know that's what was going on. And he had looked.
Took it though, because I feel like that was kind of like a gap in reality, not a criticism, just a observation. I feel like it was a gap in reality because did she do that? Like, I feel like because she started this long, like, soliloquy, right? This whole thing about doing the right thing and this is what happens and you need to say no, rebuke, did it. At what point did she put the lasso around him? We never see.
To be honest, as a way to make it make sense, I suppose, I think when she was giving that speech, she was literally, Max think she's talking to him, and that's probably when she did it. She's like, okay. He's like, no, I'm not talking to you. And then I think that's when she did it.
And I thought that was interesting, too, because she was able to get it around him and use it, like, as a vessel to talk to the people through him. Mm-hmm. And then she had to show him like what he had did and, you know, basically talk about his son and everything like that. And
it's that part when Max was realized what he had done and then show his son and all the chaos. Because at this point, the world's going to chaos. Russia and USA launching nuclear missiles. We're about to end in 2.5 seconds. And then you got the son out here trying to find his dad in the middle of the chaos. Max Alora is like, oh shit, my son's really in danger. I think that part, that's the part where is where I really started to get emotional. I don't know what about that scene.
I'm not even gonna lie, that part got me too. Like that whole scene right there, because it's like I was telling Nada earlier, he was in that moment was able to redeem himself. And it's very rare that villains are able to do that, especially after all the stuff that he single-handedly did. So it's like it's kind of hard, but he was able to do so, and it was through him renouncing his wish that everything just kind of went back to normal. Like, notice when he said that everything kind of like disappeared, like all the missiles disappeared, everything went back. Well, it's still destruction there, but the world is still intact.
Right. It undoes like most of the really, really bad stuff. But, you know, in that same scene, you know, they showed us Maxwell's childhood.
And you got a backstory with him, a little backstory with him.
So I think that also helped in humanizing him, and it also, like, I was already kind of on point with him anyway with his motivations, because he didn't want to look bad for his son. Like, I feel like that's a lot to do so that your son didn't think you're a loser. But when you look at all he went through, he had abusive father,
abusive to him,
how they didn't have much growing up, how he was picked on as a child growing up. So you can see how he could be this insecure man and how he started the very humble beginnings of black gold.
Yeah. Black and black gold. Yeah.
Whatever that corporation is. But how all that kind of started, you know, you see, well, you know, he's just an insecure guy and he got a chance to get power. Wouldn't we all succumb to the same thing? Like,
And what I thought was interesting too was them showing the clips of the people saying, I renounce my wish in their languages.
Yeah.
Like, you heard the various different languages, but did you notice that when they shot or when they went to Barbara, she didn't say anything.
She didn't say a thing.
She just had to come to grips that she just didn't have that power anymore. That's why I said they're leaving it open for more from her.
Yeah, I definitely feel like she's going to come back. Like I said, she just turned out the one where she's like, wait.
I'm not giving this up. Like, she said that when they were in the White House, she was like, I'm not giving all that. No, when they were at that.
And that shows you right there that she's going to be the one that cannot be redeemed. Like, she's at this point, she's lost. Like, she's gone. She's out there. She just doesn't have the abilities right now, but she's going to go seek it. She's going to go seek it out so it can be permanent.
Yeah. And then she's going to be able to transform back. And then we'll see. Then she'll really think it's Diana's fault. She's going to, you know, she thought Diana was at fault anyway. She said, you had all this stuff. You know, we have nothing, and you have everything.
Yep, you have everything and I have nothing. And then when she told her to get used to it and walked out, I said,
when Diana was getting weak and she was like, and you're still talking to me, like she would say, she was still speaking to her in a condescending way because Diana's like, you don't want to do this, you're giving all this up. And she's like, you just want to keep it all for yourself. Like, she wasn't trying to hit it.
Right.
I can get with Cheetah. I can get with both of the villains in the movie. Like Maxwell, I see his point. Cheetah, I see her point. And I think the overarching thing about it, obviously it's all about truth, and with the truth, there's nothing, da 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 da. But it revealed all these aspects of human nature. Mm-hmm. Like, I think throughout the film, you look at the different people. Diana had she was dealing with loss and then trying to mature emotionally. All that kind of stuff. Cheetah was dealing with wanting to feel accepted. Maxwell wanted to be accepted. He wanted his son to look up to him. And he also was greedy as hell. So, like, all these aspects of human nature, which kind of brought it back around, like I said, more to Aries' whole thing about how humans are just trash.
To go back to a little bit, I should have brought this up, and it was a funny part with Maxwell Lord when he first discovered he had that power. When he had went back to his office and saw his receptionist wasn't there, and he went to the office and the phones was ringing off the hook. He says, "Don't you wish you had some help?" She said, "I wish I had some help." Then all of a sudden I saw that there was this ad for a job. He said, "You're hired." And then all these people started coming.
Like, wow. Dude, this whole movie has so many beautiful points, mm-hmm. that it's harking back to the first film, but also back to reality as well. Mm-hmm. So, unfortunately, I would have to disagree with some of the criticism that some people may have about the film. Even though I understand it, mm-hmm. right, where they're coming from, but I feel as though, you know, with how the film looks, my thing is, pretty sure anyone who reads comic books know that there's a DC. Yes, we know the DC heroes tend to be more serious, but Each character isn't really the same. Mm-hmm. Batman is obviously going to be much more darker because his past and everything is much more intense and serious. Yes, Superman is also intense as well because his entire race was destroyed. But what he stands for is much more hopeful. Batman stands for justice.
And he has more celebrity. You know what I mean? Like, they... Exactly.
And, you know, and then Wonder Woman... Yeah, serious too, but also she's an ancient warrior, you know, who also stands for truth and love, and also justice as well, but also a some degree of hope. Mm-hmm. But greater is love as well. And, you know, so when I hear these reviews saying, oh, it's not, basically, it's not like overly serious in tone, nature, and how it looks and everything, like, you know, the Snyderverse, I'm like, because it's not supposed to. You can have a serious thing, but
there's five more thumbs down, just so you know.
Guess what? They can come. They can go crawl back in the little hole then. you know, and you know, like I said, I don't mind it. It's just you can't have everyone look the same. Is really my point is, you know, people. You have Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman. They all are three different characters. They're the Trinity, mm-hmm. and they all stand for something.
Yeah. You know, the movie isn't perfect by any stretch of the imagination.
Not perfect.
No. And, you know, like I said, I don't get into the whole critiques. I have questions that any layperson, you know, anybody that's looking, be like, okay, whatever. But I also know that, once again, it is a comic book film. Like, it's fantastical. Mm-hmm. That's the whole point of it. Like, it's not reality. You should suspend some belief. And I really felt like a kid again when I watched this movie. It reminded mm-hmm. me. And I know that the you know, I keep saying Superman, but and obviously the Superman ties DC, Superman ties Patty, blah, blah, blah. But it really made me feel like I did. I'm an 80s kid, right? So when I saw that movie, I was still a child. So I had the same feeling watching this movie that I had watching that one. And that's how I, you know, determine whether or not a family is good to me. Like, I don't get paid to critique stuff. I just get my opinion. Mm-hmm. You know, things that I appreciate. And I appreciate this movie. I appreciate the visuals that it gave me. I appreciate the story. I know a lot of people say that the story was a mess, but I feel like I was able to follow it. I don't know why. I was able to follow the story.
I was following it.
I was following it, you know, the story as well.
He hadn't watched a whole lot of other. He hadn't watched a lot of critiques on it yet. O'Shea, you and I have probably seen more than he has, so we've seen more of the questionable things.
I've heard you know little rumblings and everything like that, and a lot of them sound like you know the same. I said the only person I probably will watch is Jody, honestly speaking, because I know he'll give an unbiased opinion, even though he's a hardcore Wonder Woman fan.
Yeah, but he also you know. It includes the technicality and everything, but also, you know, gives the real and awesome, which is, and that's what we love him for. You know, like I said, I was able to follow the story just fine. I suppose if I had any critique, like I said, other than it's just that I wish the final fight between her and Cheetah was just a little bit longer.
Yeah, I said, and I also said that I wish there was a little bit more action in it, because I felt like it was one part in the movie where it was just like a bunch of just a bunch of dialogue, like a little too much dialogue in it. But and also the fight scene between her and Cheetah one being a little bit longer. But other than that, I enjoyed it, and I said it, and I told Nada early, and I'll say it right now: Maxwell Lord, Pedro Pascal, phenomenal, flawless performance.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I was telling her, I know him being Mando on the Mandalorian, and he's usually pretty much one note on there. But in this role right here, he had some range. I mean, range. And that's what you're supposed to do as an actor. And I think, you know what, when it comes to acting and doing like comic book movies, I think they, if they're a very good actor, will have a lot of fun with the project because it's an adaptation of a character that maybe they're not familiar with, or they are familiar with, and they have, and they're imagine your research. Okay, we're gonna give you this comic book, and we want you to just read it. Like, read this, like, and watch how the words are written, and watch their facial expressions of how they're drawn. We want you to bring that, but we don't want you to bring just that. We want you to bring something else, you know, with it as well. Because look at Heath Ledger. He did not bring Jack Nicholson's Joker.
No, he did not.
He didn't bring Cesar Romero's Joker. He brought his own interpretation of it and blew it out of the water. It's just unfortunate that he passed before he was able to see what would be considered his best work.
Yeah.
The thing with these kind of films is they allow the actors to take these characters who are already exaggerated. You know what I mean? Because they're exaggerated because it's for entertainment, right? So they get to take these characters who are already exaggerated and they get to add nuances to them. You know what I mean? Like, they add like little bits and pieces. Like, we say Kristen Wiig brought in like a bit of her comedic kind of thing to the Barbara Minerva, made her a little more endearing. Because like at the beginning of the film, Barbara, I was like, Team Barbara, like, that's my girl. Even though I knew she was going to be the villain, I still was like, I like you. And I can see how you go down this path. Like, and even with Maxwell, when I first met him, I was like, oh, he's sleazy. He does this and that. But then Pedro brings in that other side of him, which humanizes him. And he's just struggling. Like, he's struggling with acceptance and all this kind of stuff. So that's the beauty of having these comic book movies or, you know, whatever, these
adaptations.
Adaptations, because you can kind of bring them, you bring a little bit extra to the role, you flesh it out a little bit more. They're already, like I said before, already exaggerated characters because they're comic book characters, but then you get add just a little bit more on top of it, and it comes across really well. And I really think they all knocked it out of the park in this film.
I don't know if y'all have ever, not to switch gears, but I don't know if y'all have ever seen this movie called Oz the Great and Powerful.
I have not.
Okay, basically, it's a prequel to The Wizard of Oz. It's basically showing how Oz landed in the land of Oz. The actress Mila Kunis, who played Jackie on that 70s show.
And she on The Family Guy. She played the voice.
Meg on The Family Guy, yep. She played one of the witches in the movie, but no one knew who she played until it got revealed. And what I like, the reason why I'm bringing that up is because her character in that movie was she was young, she was naive, just like how Barbara was in this movie. And she goes through a transformation when she sees the person that she ends up liking, who is Oz. Like, she ended up developing a liking for him, and then all of a sudden she sees him hanging around who will become Glinda the Good Witch. And she becomes, you know, like, jealous and everything like that. And she has a spell on her where when she cried, her face started to burn. And I said, wait a minute. She cried and her face started to burn. And then I put two and two together. I said, she's going to become the Wicked Witch of the West because what happened to her? Water makes her melt.
Right.
So when she started to cry and the streaks went and burned on her face and it hurt her to like that, then her sister gave her an apple. She ate that apple that was supposed to like clear up her scars, but instead it had a different effect on it. It turned her green.
Okay.
And that's how the Wicked Witch of the West was born. And from there, she never turned back. Just like how with Barbara, started off the same way, very naive, you know, and shy and awkward. And then something happens through her transformation. And when Diana tries to tell her to renounce her wish, she was like, I'm not going, you know, that's not happening. She ended up liking it. She, even though it completely deformed her, she did not want to go back to that old life. She was over that. She enjoyed having that power.
Yeah.
That's why I said she's going to be that formidable foe going forward. Now, speaking of foes, who do you think would be another good villain to bring in for the third movie? Because you know they're going to bring someone else in. They're going to bring Cheetah back. We're going to declare that. But who do you think they're going to bring in?
Can we talk about that special moment before we...
Okay.
I mean, are we okay with talking about that?
Yeah, we can, most definitely.
So, obviously, this is for a review. I mean, at this point, I feel like 95% of y'all have seen the movie by now because you could have watched it at home.
Exactly.
In the, is it like a mid-credit? Because not really, is it an end credit?
I guess you could say it's a mid-credit because the credits wasn't all the way rolled through before they had brought her up. And the thing is, I knew that she was going to have a cameo because they had said it, but I'm like, where is this cameo at? Because the movie is done and I haven't seen her yet. And then when that credit came up, I was like, oh, that must be her.
I thought it was going to be when she had the golden eagle armor, because you saw the eyes, right? And I was like, damn, those eyes look, you know, when I saw the blue eyes, I was like, this has got to be Linda. It's got to be her. And then, you know, they have the mid-credit scene, which prior to that, you see Diana still flying in the clouds and doing all this kind of stuff, getting more acclimated with flying, and then she zooms off to save the day. Like, she takes that, I don't know, the Superman pose when she flies off. Hey. But then it cuts to, like, a carnival or something like that, maybe. A carnival, and you see this, just see the silhouette of this woman walking who looks like it could be Diana. She's got on a blue cloak. And at first I was like, oh, Diana's just walking down this thing. And you see this long flowing hair. And then obviously there's something like a pole is falling and it's about to hit a kid. And you see this arm come out and it's got a gold, what is it?
Gauntlet
on it. And when I saw that gold gauntlet, because Diana's gauntlet doesn't look anything like that.
Yeah, hers are like silver or something like that.
Yeah, I said, this is Linda Carter. Because
hers is gold.
When she put that hand up and called it, like my heart, so I said, then it's going to be her. It's going to be
And like I was telling you earlier, and I'll say the O'Shea, Linda Carter is a DMV native. She is from Silver Spring, Maryland. So when she turned around, the people in my theater started clapping. Because that's the OG Wonder Woman right there. Like people are, when they think of Wonder Woman and you know, like that, they think of her before anything. And you know, that when they were trying to cast Wonder Woman for the movies, like who they have Gal as now, that had to be one of the hardest castings ever to do because everybody said, we don't want a Linda Carter, but we want a Linda Carter. So it was like, it was kind of hard for them to do. And I think they found a diamond in the rough when they got Gal.
Absolutely.
Because she looks like, she kind of looks like her in a younger format. She has she from head to toe, she is Wonder Woman. She is Diana Prince. Like you said earlier, I couldn't see anybody else playing that role. Like when Gal hangs it up and she's not playing Wonder Woman anymore, if they decide to do another Wonder Woman movie down the line, let it be more years down the line because, you know, we're going to, because let it be like 10, 20 more years before, because think about it. Linda Carter played Wonder Woman in the mid to late 70s, and we didn't get another Wonder Woman until 2016.
Yeah.
Look at that gap. Look how many Batmans we've had, how many Supermans we've had. But it took them this long to get one Wonder Woman.
Right, that part.
There's other things going on around it. However, I do feel what you're saying. I'm just letting you know, I screamed, like literally screamed when I saw her turn around and it was Linda Carter.
I was trying to have been there to witness that, you screaming.
Oh my God. And I was like,
and she still looks good.
Oh my God.
For her age.
Oh, she is eternally beautiful. She would always, she just ages so well.
Right. She is.
And she said, I'm a dread, what's her name? Asteria.
Yeah.
You know, whatever, the warrior, the strongest Amazon warrior, whatever. And she's like, I've been doing this for a while. It's like, you know, just like a little callback. Like I've been in the game for a while. You know what I mean? It was really cute to me.
Mm-hmm. I love it. What would be dope though is they bring her back for the third film and have her and Diana like meet.
I think that's what they're trying to do. I really feel, well, now we'll never know because Patty, you know, doesn't have she's not there anymore. But I really think I feel like this was kind of like introducing Linda in this universe, and Diana was looking for her anyway, because, you know, Diana knew that she was out there. Diana has been, you know, she left the mascara. She knows there's another Amazon. She was trying to locate her. She was able to find her armor and to know that she's still around somewhere. Like, I feel like they're going to link up and she's going to like guide Diana along the way, because she was like the best Amazon they had.
Yeah.
And so Diana has now filled that spot. So she's like, let me show you the ropes, young buck. Like, I feel like that's going to happen, or was going to happen in Wonder Woman 3.
Do you think that with them now releasing Wonder Woman 84 on Christmas Day, that they shoehorn that Christmas scene in there because of that?
Patty said she said even when it was going to be released in 2019, she said it just had to work out that way.
Look, it's like the planets aligned and it fit right in. And you know what I thought was interesting too was in that scene when she's watching the kids play and everything like that, and the guy comes up and talks to her, and he's wearing the same clothes that Steve had on. I said, even more so than that, I like that scene because that was her finally opening up to other options and letting go slowly of Steve. Like, you could tell she was looking at that guy up and down, smiling every time. Every time she looked at him, she was smiling. She know what? There might be something to this letting go
thing. Right. It's like, okay, I'm going to give it a try. Okay, let me just know it's where my options are here, okay?
Even looking at her from the beginning of the film, so in the beginning of the film, she's obviously a very beautiful woman, right? All these men approach, she's like, nope. She's curving folks left and right. And so then at the end of the movie, like you said, you see her open up because she's finally she's letting go of Steve. Like, even like stuff like that, because at the beginning of the movie, she was just so standoffish. I was like, I mean, I guess I see why she's that way. And then O'Shea saying, you know, she can't form these relationships because she's going to outlive everybody. But then to see that transition, like, this movie had a lot of arcs in it.
Yeah.
Like, Maxwell, I think, had the biggest one. He had the biggest arc in the film.
Yeah,
and then I would probably say, you know, Barbara. And then, you know, I put Diana last because, she wasn't perfect. She was close. You know, she has her issues, but hers was more subtle. Theirs was, like, more prominent, you know, just out there. But, like, even seeing the way she interacted with people near the end of the film when she was talking to that guy who had that god-awful outfit on that she put together, she was like, this is good. And Steve was like, I'm not wearing this. We ain't doing that.
No. But clearly looks good on that one guy. So she's like, oh, okay, yeah. Here's my phone number that I probably don't have the phone.
Just so this isn't a full-on love fest, even though I feel like it is, are there any, not critiques, but maybe some, you have any of those moments in the film?
I have to really think about it, to be honest.
I would say the good outweighed the bad.
I would agree.
I would say, like I said, other than my minor critique of the fight could have been, I would say I agree with Tyron with you guys that it could be a little more action. I noticed that Wonder Woman wasn't as much in the film.
Probably because she was there, though. She had impact. I think I disagree with you on the action part, because I think the Cairo scene, her fight scene in the White House, seeing her do little things around the film, you know, that was good for me. Like, I always like to see a longer fight scene, but like seeing her kind of in action, I felt like there was a good balance of that going on. Mm-hmm.
So basically, too much action would be something like, you know, the Man of Steel final battle, him and Zod.
I'm not taking the bait on that, okay? Like,
you plead the fifth. I think if I not deny that question.
But yeah, I think like Taurine said, like it was the good outweighed the, in my opinion, the good outweighed the bad. Like I said before.
I also agree as well.
I'm based on feelings. Like, how did I feel coming in? I have a couple moments where I was like, sure, you know, whatever. But also, I kept in the back of my mind, it's a fantastical thing. Like, this is not reality. So it should have some stuff that makes you go, ooh, is that real? Like, can it happen? Like, you know what I'm saying? Wakanda ain't real, but we accept it, you know what I'm saying? Because of the film. So it was good to me. I could always take a little bit more of Themyscira. I want to see Diana go back and connect with her people. So I think in the third installment, because Gal had signed on for 3, I believe. For the third one, I would like to see her go back home because we know it's going to be set in modern time whenever that happens.
Yeah, and like I said, in the third one, I want to see her take on a villain that is so like extremely powerful, because I remember watching a clip from one of the animated Wonder Woman movies where she had to fight Medusa. And Medusa was like in there in the mega state. I forgot what it was called.
A Wonder Woman Bloodlines, where she.
I think that's what it was.
When you see, remember when Cheetah got all buffed up? Because remember Cheetah took that it was some serum.
That kind of serum, and he got that extreme agility, beat her ass in that truck. But the one I'm talking about when she fight Medusa.
Yeah, it's
same. If they recreate that, that's gonna be now. That one will probably have you doing the ugly cry. Because when she had to fight her, because you know with Medusa, if you look at her, she'll turn you into stone. So in order to fight her, she poured acid onto her eyes and blinded herself.
Yeah.
I can just imagine the agony of doing that just so she could fight Medusa and beat her. And barely beat her then.
Yeah. I would love to see that fight, yeah.
But Tomasa, well, obviously the third film, they're going to go bigger. Go harder, you know. Also being set, I feel it'll be set in present day. But I think, according to Patty in one of her interviews, that you know, if she obviously leaves it open for a new director to come on, I'm sure she'll give that director say, "Hey, this is where I want the story to Diana's story to kind of conclude here, or continue on whichever direction you want to do." But I'm pretty sure us fans want to have Gal Gadot play Wonder Woman for as long as she can. That third film should be like, you know, something that also coincides with today's world of 2020, how with COVID, how Diana would wrestle with that. But also adding Cheetah, the fact that, you know, Cheetah has now become permanently Cheetah through the Cheetah Goddess, and that and then of course you have
I also said the possibility of throwing Cersei in there because she's a witch.
Cersei, yeah.
And Cersei's ability is her. And Cersei's ability is to turn people into animals.
Yeah.
Or into creatures.
Yeah. I think that at that point, the third film, like you said, is go big or go home. Like, you got to pull out all the stops. So
yeah.
I do agree with Cheetah coming back. I do agree with Cersei because there might be a device to get Cheetah there as opposed to if they don't go the route with the Cheetah God. But I think at this point, it has to be an all-out war with, like, Olympus. Like, in my mind, I feel like that's the only thing that
could be big. Like, have her fighting with, like, more gods?
Yeah, I just feel like that's the only thing that can, like...
And have her go back home. Yeah, have her go back home where, she, like, where her mother needs Diana now. Because now Diana, of course... Oh, and also, this time, also, all bring everything concludes. So you also even have Asteria. Linda Carter come back in there as well.
That's what I'm saying. That's how I'm trying to tie it all together.
And also, since we're talking about her looks, we've already seen her in her regular costume. We see her in the Golden Eagle armor. I want to see her in that other costume with the silver tiara, the blue, and the red.
Oh, the new 52.
The one from the comic book, the new 52 look.
I forgot. I don't know the technical name. It looks like she looks like I don't know how to call it, but all I know is the color scheme. As a matter of fact, when we were talking about that fight that she had with Cheetah in the animated series when she was fighting her in the truck, she had that that suit.
Oh, that's the New 52 one where she basically it's where she took part of Nupti 2 was red and blue, silver tiara, silver gauntlets, and then, but she added, like, I won't say not leggings, but, you know.
You want the pants, or you just want the...
Pants?
No.
At what point she had, like, leggings on in that costume?
No, she wasn't wearing pants. She was wearing, like, leggings, because, like, I think Nupti 2 Wonder Woman, she wore, like, a skirt, right? Or no? Or was it the swimsuit one?
I cannot. Hold on. Let me see.
Hold on. Let me see what I can find.
No, I think Tyrion's talking about the outfit Wonder Woman had in Wonder Woman Bloodlines.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
We should find Cheetah. We should find Cheetah in that one.
Then she also has the one she wore in the, what was that? The Justice League? Where she had the one with the three stars, like the stars and the red with the gold plate going across the top. Hmm. Or also introduce her cape.
Oh, the cape one.
The star and stripes cape.
That's the one. That one right there. That's the one I'm talking about.
Hmm.
That's really like a combination of the swimsuit one mixed with the new 52 mixed with it's like three costumes somewhat melt into one. I mean, you know, well, to be honest, Tari, I mean, you know, with today's world, with that outfit, with Diane Gal Gadot wearing that,
I already know what they're gonna say.
Gonna be like little two.
Yeah, like, I already know.
Like her vagina is literally right there. It's like,
well, shoot, did you see the dress that she had when she got out of the car? The minute she lifted that leg up any higher, that thing.
Damn.
we already talked about crotch shots. Remember when she did the first Wonder Woman when she had the costume on and she was standing over?
Oh,
Steve?
Yeah. Oh yeah, she's standing. Right. Like, bro, we're crotch shots in his face. Like he's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, that kind of goes back to Linda Carter's original costume, which was like the swimsuit, right?
Yeah, and you see, the thing is, back then they could get away with that. They say, you know what, Linda, you're not talking right now, so we need you to run, just keep run, just run.
I mean, you had Psylocke, right? Psylocke and X-Men.
Yeah, so also has a, well, hers like a bodysuit, but yeah, it's kind of like that. Where it kind of wraps around, like, yeah, you can see, you basically see her ass is basically out.
Everything. So like, I just don't. Yeah, I mean, they can make it happen. I don't know if it will work for the story since they have her like as such a warrior. Like it has to have a warrior look and feel to it.
And plus, and plus, also, you know, I don't think they're gonna change it because unfortunately, Zach originally casted Gal Gadot and he had the original costume design. Everyone else kind of tweaked it with the colorations. So. I don't think they're gonna do it.
I don't know if y'all picked up on it though. I'm glad this clicked in my head. Going back to the movie, remember at the end where she was at the carnival and the kid had let the little balloon up in the air and it was a red star, like on the shield. I said that immediately stuck out to me. I said there goes that red star.
One of her
symbols.
I mean, I saw it as her like looking up to the clouds and not being sad about it when, you know, think about Steve. Instead of looking up with, you know, she looked up with hope this time as you opposed to looking up with sadness.
You know, it could do since they added the star balloon like that. Since, you know, in the Wonder Woman in the Justice League animated series, how she had this red star on her
tiara. Yeah, in the tiara.
Right. Maybe they can have that for the third film, but also have her armor. Like an amalgamation of the gold, the armor, the red, the blues. Kind of like how her armor was in the Justice League Apocalypse War. You know, in the Flash, right, where they're facing the Paradooms, her armor was kind of patterned after Gal Gadot's outfit. Kind of like have it that, but have it like the red star. Like, kind of like, you know, kind of like the tie-in, like a little nostalgia, you know, for all those who've ever watched that show.
Yeah, if Patty was doing it, I have 100% faith in it. I don't know if Patty's not.
I think now people's faith has been shooken.
Shook. You hear me? Shook it.
Because now everyone's going to be looking at the new director like with all eyes,
mm-hmm.
like a hawk saying, "Okay,
that's a lot of pressure."
That's a lot of times. They, like I said, the third one, you got to bring it. And I think, like, it should stop at three. I feel like movies.
Yeah. And I think he's only been contracted to do three, though. So yeah, it probably will stop at three. Three is enough to wrap up the story.
You sure?
No, I think three is enough. Like, anything other than that, like, the fact that...
I mean, they might as well, because it's like, it's not connecting to anything at this point. They're just on their own.
Yeah, nothing really connecting anymore, to be honest. So, yeah, you're right.
I think I said this other night, DC is better off not trying to connect it, because...
Yeah, they can't get it right.
They can't get it right. And at this point, they're chasing behind Marvel. Like, stop chasing behind Marvel. Do your own little thing. If you do... independent, you know, like standalone films, and they have maybe just like a slight thread, but like, don't try to follow it all the way through, because you get our hopes up and then stuff happens.
Yeah, stuff happened, and it's coming out as well in March of next year.
Besides that, right there, I also, do y'all find it strange that whenever Wonder Woman, because this is now the second one, but just like the first time, right before the film comes out, all this negative press comes out, like people saying it's just a mess. Like, I was looking at people like, this movie is not good.
And then, I vaguely remember them trying to trash the first one. I'm like, I enjoyed the first one, especially since the first that movie helped save the DC universe.
At that time, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, at that time.
And so ironic that they're doing the same thing again, saying this is just a mess. That one's kind of, you know, it's too campy. It's not like this, basically not like the Snyder cut version of one.
It's set in the '80s, where camp was king. Campy, campy, campy was a thing. It has subtle homages to.
Well, unfortunately, these people obviously probably weren't born in the '80s. Or
that's because a lot of the people who are saying that now were born after a certain year, and they think drinking cough syrup is like drinking juice.
it was all diluted. We're so, like, you know, desensitized to everything now. So, you know, that what color? There's no color. That's why I always be making jokes in our Hive episodes about how, like,
color.
Yeah, how it's so much of an overcast. I always say this, Tari. I always be making jokes at why is it always an overcast? But when you come to films like Aquaman, Shazam, and not 184, oh, no. It's a clear blue, clear day, you can see everything.
there's a clear vision in mind with those overcast films, you know, make it gritty, make it more realistic.
And those same reviewers, people that I've listened to just for the hell of it, when they watch this film, they've already checked out.
Because of the color?
Because how
it's too much color for them.
It's just too much color.
But they shouldn't watch it anyway.
The sun's out too much, the clouds, and her armor's,
And what were they expecting it to look like? Did they really think it was supposed to look like the first one? That would have really took me out of it.
No, Taryn. They were expecting it to look like, yes, like the first one, but also even more so like her armor looked in BVS.
It looked almost the exact same as in the first one.
Yeah,
red and all that. Yeah, those colors that you get brown, red, they blend together.
One thing I did like though that they did with this one is they took the sword and shield out and let her lasso shine.
You know,
because I feel like they did not allow the lasso to really do much in the first one because they were hiding behind the God Killers too much.
Which leads to another critique that some people have as well, Katarian, is that when they took that away, there was like, why is the lasso doing all this? Like, it's not obeying any laws of physics. I'm just like, listen, people, it's called the magic lasso. From the Greek gods, you use magic. It's not supposed.
They must think this is the 70s with Linda Carter when she had to do a simple actual lasso, like she was hogged, like she was about to get a bull by the horn. I said, what they were doing in the what they showed in the comic books with Wonder Woman is what she was doing in the movie,
right?
Like, that's why they call it an adaptation. And I'm glad that they let the lasso shine, because that right there is what we've known her for. Like, when I used to watch old episodes of Wonder Woman, I never seen her with a sword or a shield. She always had her lasso. Yeah,
even in the Justly animated series, she just had the lasso.
Which makes me kick myself even more now for missing that question on that Jeopardy for that Jeopardy question, Turin.
I was hot, did you?
But Nada, how did you not know that?
Like, how did you not know
that? You just have a moment where your mind just like shuts down. I was like, what's the most of her weapon? She don't have a weapon. What are we talking? No, it's the lasso. And that was the only thing she used in this movie. Like, when I saw it so much, I was like,
see, when this is done, and now that I've seen the movie, I can skip ahead into the parts that I really want to watch. I'm about to go watch all them fight scenes again. I'm about to go watch them fight scenes again, and I can go back and watch it again and again until I'm tired of watching it.
I also think that Tyron, you're gonna also watch replay a certain scene of Barbara when she's getting used to her strength. The gym scene.
Oh yeah, that part right there was crazy because it's like she walked up into the gym, she grabbed the little, you know, the little girly weight and did one little bicep curl. She's like, nah, let me move up a couple more weights. Nah, let me grab this one. Nah, that's not it. And then did a whole.
She did a clean. She just, pulled it right up here.
And right up there, and the reaction from the guys was like priceless. They was like, she did that with no effort, no straining, no grunt, and just dropped it. And the weight came off.
Right.
And he just walked away. Like, just dropped it and just stepped over and walked away.
The Bible was like, what?
She was shocked herself. Like, she was like, am I really doing this right now?
I like how she would do the curl and she would look around and be like, oh, okay, let me get a bigger weight. Oh, okay.
Still ain't nothing. Damn, this ain't nothing either. I'm bench pressed. I'm like, oh, okay. Really?
And what I thought was so funny, though, was how she was dressed going in there. Because, you know, that's how the women used to dress going into the gym. You know, and it was nothing to it. Like, they literally came in there like they was going to the beach.
Yeah. You know, to be honest, I literally want to ask women about that. Obviously you all don't have, you know, penis, so I'm just like, when y'all wear stuff like that, the bodysuits and the swimsuits and basically what y'all wore, like stuff like that, what Bob was wearing in the 80s, are you telling me that that did not irritate, you know, your vagina at all? Like,
no, it's just like when you wear underwear.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Unless it's too small, and then you have some problems because it's cutting up into certain things. But for the most part, it's just like wearing bathing suit bottoms, wearing underwear.
Nowadays, you have some women going into the gym wearing full face of makeup. I'm like, do you know where you're headed? Now you're gonna be looking like the Joker, like makeup just running down your face.
Yeah, after all that sweat.
You know,
I never understood that, but to be honest, I think my logic behind it was like, I think they're literally looking for their next boyfriend or husband.
Oh yeah, most definitely. Because, you know, most of them, they don't go to the gym and don't bust not one sweat, but they'll post a selfie on Instagram. And I'm like, you don't even look like you lifted one weight or walked on one treadmill or climbed one stair.
Yeah. I go to the gym to work out, and yes, I do sweat. Like, yeah, it's going to happen.
Everybody has a different goal when they walk into the gym, y'all. They just have a different goal.
Well, unfortunately, at my gym, they go to do that. Sweat, take pics, and
Nada, you know, you've seen them people in your gym before. In the gym, you
go my gym is pretty rough. My gym is old school, so like you come in to sweat. Yeah, it ain't no time for that.
not here. I said all the young folks, here. No, we're all about Instagram and tweeting. Like, I'm working,
and they come up in there with, you know, like their fresh nails did, talk about I'm about to break a nail. Then why did you go and get your nails did? Knowing you was about to lift them weights.
I feel like Barbara has led us down a rabbit hole. Let's come back.
Okay.
Let's come back. So final thoughts on the film before we give it. So we give a grade here. But it's not a letter grade. It's actually lips.
Yes.
On a scale of 1 to 5. 1 being bad, 5 being the best. Mm-hmm. So that's how we grade things. You don't have to do all the extra stuff that O'Shea and I might do. You can just give your opinion on it, and then we'll go from there.
Okay. All right. Overall, I really did enjoy this film. Listen, this movie has to go into the Guinness Book of World Records for the most pushbacks. How many times did this movie get pushed back?
At least
six times.
I missed that question on the Jeopardy. It was 6 times it got pushed back.
It had to get pushed like 6 times. Okay.
Yeah.
As many times as, you know, this movie got pushed back, it was definitely, I guess you could say, worth the wait. I really did have fun watching this movie, and now looking at it in hindsight, I'm glad they have the option that you can look at it streaming angle and see it, because now, you know, like I just said, when this is over, I'm gonna go and watch bits and pieces of it again, just, you know, to relive what I saw at 11 a.m. But I really did enjoy this movie. It was a fun movie. It was a dramatic movie. It literally had multiple genres snowballed into one film, and a lot of movies cannot do that. Some can only do one. Some try to do some and it doesn't work, but I like that they had drama, they had action, they had comedy in there, but they didn't oversaturate it. Like, they didn't hit you over the head with it. Like, they spread it out. Like, they, you know, they spread it out evenly. It's almost like making a sandwich. You wouldn't put all your meat on one side and put all your lettuce on the other. Like, what kind of sandwich is that? But overall, everybody did good for me. Kristen Wiig and Pedro Pascal murdered their roles. Like, they did it. Because, like I said, it goes back to the fact that Kristen Wiig comes from a comedy background. And I always say comedians can do drama. If you give them the right material, they can do it and they can kill it. And she did that. And she did not only drama, but she did action. Like, she was completely out of her element. Like, she's never done nothing like that before. And she did it on her first go around. And she, you know, absolutely phenomenal. Pedro Pascal, like, give him all kinds of nominations, because he showed a side of himself in this role that I've never seen from him before, ever. Because I know he used to do some work on Game of Thrones at one point. And he wasn't even doing that in there. In Game of Thrones, that's full of nothing but dramatic acting and action. But in this role right here, it's something that, like I told you earlier, that he tapped into and he was able to pull out of. But it also shows that he did decent research on who he was playing. He didn't just jump up and say, oh, I can handle this character. I don't need to look him up. He's just another comic book villain. He's going to be simple to play. No, not everybody can handle these type of roles. But he showed that he could carry this role. And this character went through multiple levels of emotions. Like, he had highs and he had lows, and he had some consolidating points. And he was able to hit every mark when it was supposed to be hit. I wonder if Patty told him to tone down at all when he was performing. Because I could imagine she probably said, okay, that was good, but I need you to scale it back a little bit. Because usually when a director says you got to scale it back, that means you're doing too good. You're doing way too good. We like what you're doing, but keep that energy, but bring it down a couple of notches. Especially that part when he was talking to the president. When the nose was bleeding, that part right there. That part right there is when I thought he was about to leap across that desk. I thought he was about to go across that desk and, like, choke the president. But yeah, I really enjoyed the movie. But if I had to give it a rating, I would say I'd give it a 4.5 out of 5.
All right.
Respectable.
Cool. We'll save the best for last now, though. So for me, like I said, I can't possibly compare it to the first one, like I said, because I feel like it's just two different chapters in one of one's life. And I feel like going forward, that's how I'm going to see it. It just be another chapter in Diana's life. Like, much like the third film, it'll be the conclusion of Diana, her character. But obviously, we'll see her in other cameos on the films, obviously. But this one particularly, this film hit me with all the emotions and feelings. I thought I would never even tear up and cry, especially for that scene where Maxwell Lord realizes that he was doing so much damage that it's putting his son in danger. And I guess when I saw him hug his son, I suppose it reminded me of, you know, as someone who is somewhat, I would say, somewhat a part of the LGBT community. I say somewhat because I don't really get involved with them like that. That I'm constantly afraid to tell my dad the truth about me because he doesn't know. I keep this part of my life just away from certain people because I know my family, some of them are very old school set in the ways, and you know, So when I saw that scene, it harkened back to me and my struggles of who I am, what I go through. And, you know, and this, and the whole message behind this film of greed and power, that, you know, with given the right opportunity, we would seek out more, the betterment of ourselves, because we're just selfish like that. Regardless if it's going to hurt anyone else, as long as we're happy, it's all that matters, right? And the fact that it also connects back to what Ari said in the first film, and then you bring in someone like the God of Lies, through his creation, the stone, it really kind of kicks it into higher gear now, saying like, truth and greed, truth is the only way to go. And like Diana said in the first film, only love can save the world. So, as far as rating, I'm going to give it a 5 out of 5 juicy lips.
Okay. I guess I got to bring us home, right? So, yep. As always, and as I've said repeatedly, I judge films off of how they make me feel. You and Taryn talk, there's parts of the movie that spoke to you personally. You know, Taryn saying, you know, it's from the DMV. Like, I know that, that's my connection. And, you know, say you with your testimony about what's going on. That's the beauty of Wonder Woman, because I think even in the first film, people were able to connect to it on so many different levels. There was different things that touched somebody. And here we are again with yet another one, another masterpiece from Patty and Gal. That's my opinion that I call a masterpiece, and that's what it's going to be to me. They've done it again. You know, they brought together this ensemble cast that just worked together so well to give us a phenomenal movie. Yes, it had a couple of moments, but it wasn't enough to take me out of it. I thoroughly enjoyed this film. I'm going to watch it several more times, starting as soon as we finish this up. I'm going to go watch it. So like Corinne says, shout out to the ability to watch it on HBO Max.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. At the same time they decide the theaters, I probably will go see it in the theater again.
And see it in the format that you want to see it in.
In the format I want to see it in, because, you know, but, you know, whatever. So we already know what my score is going to be, but this film lived up to everything I wanted it to be, and it gave me a little bit more. Seeing Linda Carter at the end of that movie, like, took it to a whole nother level for me. I was already over the moon with it, but like I said, I spent 70% of my time in the theater with tears in my eyes just watching this movie. And on a more personal level, it's just seeing someone that I looked up to for so long, you know, getting their just due, seeing Wonder Woman being brought to the screen again, getting the respect that she deserves, being recognized as the hero and guiding light of DC that she is. I feel like that gets underplayed a lot. So just seeing all that culminate and seeing her get her just due and just rewards now, makes me emotional now just thinking about it. So I'm gonna go ahead and stop while I'm ahead and give this a 5 out of 5 is what I'm gonna give it.
All right.
That's, you gonna wrap this up, Jose?
Of course. So thank you, Tyrion. Oh, I can't say, I stumbled your name already. Sorry, I'm so sorry. I can't speak right now. I already freaked it up. I'm sorry, but thanks again, Tari and Rain, again for gracing your presence live as well.
I'm glad I was able to come.
And like I said, you know, as we told Jody, you are also more than welcome to appear in our any future episodes. All things DC content wise.
Okay.
Just hit us up and we'll make it happen.
Will do.
Perfect. So thanks, guys. Thank you for tuning in and watching for The Hive. This is The Widow. Shout out to Ashley. I'm watching in the distance. I'm your boy Sexy Shay for The Widow.
I'm Torian Rain Reloaded. Of Torian Rain Reloaded.
Nada.
Right, we were like, that's why I had to throw that other part in it, because I was wondering, is she going to come in and say her outro?
I'm the girl, Miss Nada. Before we forget, Merry Christmas, everybody. Happy holidays, because it is Christmas Day. or in my opinion, it's Wonder Woman Day. So it was thank y'all for joining us. I want to thank Taryn again for coming in. Shout out to O'Shea, who's my better half, for always being here. And this has been an episode.
More After Dark Times at the Hive as well. Coming soon. Yeah. Okay. More.
Okay. All right. Yeah. that's all we're going to say about that. All right, everybody.
This is.